there are pluses and there are minuses to being the size of some of these guys, but the biggest plus of all is you can't fit on this thing, Oblivion, the world's first ever vertical drop roller coaster. It cost £12 million to build, goes at 70 miles an hour, and here we go! A familiar format for this Energizer battery trophy. There are four heats, four events in each of those heats, six men taking part in each of them, but only two will go through to the big final to find Britain's strongest man. And so here we are with heat one, featuring two bus drivers, a lorry driver, a painter and a decorator, and a nerd. Brian Bell is 32, already a winner of Scotland's Strongest Man. Graham Mullins, 33. You'll see him in Steven Spielberg's forthcoming film, Gladiators. Adam's just 26, a real novice at this level. This will find him out. Gary Adams, 30 years old. He's our London bus driver. Paul Banks is 32. His four children will cheer him every inch of the way. And lastly, Neil Elliott, 28 years old, only his second ever strongman event.
Strong beer, strong men. This event's called the Carry and Drag, and that's precisely what it is. You have to carry this beer barrel and a separate sandbag down the course and then drag them both back on this particular sledge. A combined weight of 200 kilos, that's 440 pounds. Easy.
Come on, you wimps.
Well, these guys may be big, very big, but even they get nervous.
I'm a bit apprehensive about it because I think a few will burn out on dragging it back. So it's hard to say, either go for it or pace yourself, but I think I'll probably just go for it and see what happens.
Well, our commentator for Britain's Strongest Man is Paul Dickinson.
Graham Mullins from Yorkshire on this side. Next to him is Adam Townsend from Kent. Mullins is the biggest man in this heat. He's well over 6 feet tall, weighs about 22 stones.
Ready on the whistle.
So here we go. Mullins a little bit slow to get away. Townsend is quickly. He's first up with the barrel. Gary Adams in the blue T-shirt. Former Grenadier Guardsman, and on the far side, Neil Elliott in the red vest. Now, he's the lightest man in the competition. He's enjoying this part, but when he has to drag the sled, which weighs 250 kilograms in total, this could be difficult. Elliott is away, Mullins is catching up, and Townsend is coming through along with Brian Bell. Townsend just at the moment, there's Brian Bell from Dundee. It's very close for first and second place at the moment. Mullins struggling a wee bit, and Townsend is definitely coming through to first place. Tremendous effort by Adam Townsend. Neil Elliott has come to a grinding halt in the middle of the course. Townsend is going to win it just. Now, who's going to get second place? Oh, it's so close between Bell and Mullins, and Mullins is flat out. Gary Adams is struggling, as is Neil Elliott and Paul Banks on the far side. There goes the whistle. The referee will have to get his tape measure out to see who comes in fourth, fifth and sixth place, but what about the winner?
Chuffed to that. Made the points early on. Get him in, good start. Keep me head positive for the rest of it then, so.
Were you surprised to win? Because you're up against guys like Graham, he's a huge man, and Brian Bell, who's very experienced.
Yeah, but I train with some top blokes, some of them are here today, so I train heavy with them hard. So I'm not going to keep competing with them, so I'm competing with them, I'm competing with the rest of them. And I'm fit as well, having my fitness on my side, you know what I mean?
Terrific performance by Adam Townsend, 6 points, but who got second? I think it was Brian Bell on the far side.
I'm glad to pick second up and get some valuable points, because I knew that event would be quite difficult for me, because I'm not the most aerobic athlete.
It is a very tough one to start this competition with, isn't it?
I think that would be the hardest one out of the four heats, and it's a tough one to do first.
Now, which of the remaining events are you looking forward to most?
Well, there's none of my favourite, but I'm quite looking forward to the stones. And if the deadlift hold goes well, I could do well at that one as well.
Good start, well done.
Thank you.
So, and the three men finished the course, Adam, Brian and Graham. Their points allocated on time, the other three on distance covered.
Well, welcome to today's edition of Ready, Steady, Lift, in which we try and transform a 12-stone-10 weed into a strong man. And Brian is going to guide us through the whole process step by step. So, what's the first thing you have to do to transform it?
Well, first of all, we'd like to put the powerlifting suit on.
The powerlifting suit. And why do we wear this?
This keeps the whole body tight and supports the legs, the hips, the whole body. It keeps it nice and tight. Well, we need a little help, don't we?
Yeah, I'd love a bit of help. Good God. Oh, I can feel it very tight.
That's where you've got all your support in the hips.
Oh, lovely and snug. But rarely have I felt so snug around here.
After that, we'd put the knee wraps on.
And how tight should this go?
They should be really tight. You know when you've got them on, right, when you should lose all sense of feeling in your toes. Next, we'd put on the powerlifting belt, which helps support the lower back and abdominal region.
Right.
It should actually be tight as well, but
it'll
fit me quite well.
Pathetic. Okay, and last but not least?
It's the tachy for the hands. That's it, you want plenty of it.
And how do you get this stuff off?
Well, usually tough in times, but it does usually take a couple of days for it to come off.
Good. This is a one-legged strongman, because I've lost all sense of feeling in my right leg. Okay, here we go. Straight back, yeah?
Straight back, lifting with the hips. And that's it. No bother.
Doddle, and it's only 40 metres there and back.
That's it.
And we now move to the other side of the lake at Alton Towers for the deadlift, holding the car up for as long as you possibly can.
I do a lot of deadlifting. I'm pretty reasonable at deadlifting, as in one repetition. But this is holding as well. So there's a lot of willpower involved in blanking your mind out and putting yourself on another planet, if you want. Just blanking the pain out.
Neil Elliott, Scotland.
Well, we'll see Graham Mullins a little later on. The strong men going in reverse order from where they finished in the first event. So Neil Elliott, who finished last in that first event, has got a little bit of catching up to do.
Just a question of hanging on. Yeah, that's all there is. There's no real technique. It's just a case of getting in there and giving it plenty.
Last minute preparations for Neil Elliott. Jamie Reeves helping him strap himself on. And Jamie Reeves himself, former world's strongest man. That's referee Dougie Edmonds. And the initial lift is one of the hardest parts of this. Well, Neil Elliott from Helensburgh in Argyllan Butte in Scotland. Scotland's number one discus thrower and cites as his hero of all time, the four times world champion Lars Riedel. Elliott is very light, but he's very, very strong. A former Scottish powerlifting international. So in some ways, he's gone! Just over 27 seconds. Oh, my goodness gracious me, absolutely exhausted.
I think so much left tricep was going to snap.
Really?
Yeah.
What's the hardest part of it?
Just holding it. I think what it is, I must be imbalanced, you know, with the throwing.
Yeah.
And right arm was fine. Just my left tricep. Could just feel it pulling and pulling. I thought, shit, it's going to snap.
And Paul Banks, he didn't fare any better than Neil. 19.72 seconds. This is Gary Adams. Those straps are so important to help the grip. Gary from Welling in Kent.
Are you ready? Look!
Well, this is like a big deadlift in itself, but that was very, very easy. So chasing Neil Elliott's lead of 27.22 seconds. Looking very relaxed indeed. Well, this fella is a London bus driver. works hard and trains very hard as well. 2 hours every day of the week. Getting close to the target of 27 seconds, and he's gone past it. Good performance. And he's down at just over 30 seconds. Tremendous effort, and certainly 4 seconds in the lead at the moment.
Any idea of the time at all?
None at all, none at all.
You're in the lead.
Oh, it's nice to be in the lead for but one stage. I don't think I will be at the end of this, though. But it's hard work. I drive a London bus for a living, and I normally knock cars away, not picking up. So it was a bit different.
Well done.
Cheers, thanks very much.
Now it's Graham Mullen's turn. I just wonder how he's going to cope with this initial lift. He's well over 6 feet tall. It's a long way to pick it up. Oh, no problem. And Mullins has got a huge chest and a very, very strong back, making the early stages of this lift look very easy indeed. Like Gary Adams, he's a driver, drives heavy goods vehicles. He's making it look desperately easy. Now, is he overconfident? He's gone past Neil Elliott. Now he's chasing the lead of 31.07 seconds. He's in the lead and looking better and better. It's just about this stage where the hands are almost going numb. He's got to lock his knees. Oh, he's gone, but it's a tremendous time. Gary Mullins over 45 seconds and looking very confident.
I felt really comfortable with that.
Will it be enough to win?
I hope so. It is a very heavy car. I mean, I've lifted cars this way before, but I think it's the heaviest I've ever done. Thanks a lot.
Well, Brian Bell has done this sort of event before, competed in World's Strongest Man. Jamie Reeves just giving him a few hints as to the technique. Second in the first event, so he's already got good points. But that was a tremendous performance by Graham Mullins, 45.44 seconds. Bell from Teeling in Dundee weighs just over 20 stones. Now it's beginning to hurt. He's beginning to breathe quite hard. It's very, very painful. 30 seconds. Good effort by Brian Bell. He's in second place at the moment. Heading towards 40 seconds. Now, can he hang on and go for the lead? He's just short. In second place, 42.84 for Brian Bell. It's good to have the likes of Jamie Reeves up there on the stage, himself a former World's Strongest Man. One of the best strongmen Britain has ever produced is the Sheffield man. Just helping Brian Bell off the stage. And Brian has always said consistency is so important in strongman competitions.
Adam Townsend, England.
Well, Townsend being shoved out there by Paul Banks. Tremendous performance by him in the first event. But in Graham Mullins and Brian Bell, they've set a very tough target indeed. Well over 40 seconds for both. Adam Townsend from Kingsthorpe in Northamptonshire. He's not a massive man by any stretch of the imagination. Weighs under 20 stones. Ooh, a little bit unsteady there. Already beginning to feel the pressure. It's a tremendous crowd here at Alton Towers. Seconds, going well. The next target is Gary Adams, 31.07. Now then, how much longer? I'm not sure you'd want to see him in your rearview mirror if you're driving along. Oh, he's gone, 39.09 seconds, and staggering all over the place. Starved of oxygen.
wasn't looking forward to this event, so holding as much as I can. So next, it's a bit stiff, but I'm glad it's out of the way now.
Now, it looks as though, unofficially, there are three of you tied for first place on 10 points at the minute. That's going to be incredibly hard over the next two events.
Be a good day tomorrow, then, won't it? Look forward to tomorrow. Should be all right tomorrow, but that was my worst event. I wasn't looking forward to that. That's out of the way. Tomorrow's another day.
So, victory for Graham Mullins ahead of Brian Bell and Adam Townsend. And what that means after two events is it really couldn't be closer at the top. Three of them locked together on 10 points apiece. And for Graham Mullins, well, he's really relishing the occasion.
When I was lifting just then, things were starting to get painful. But you give a little roar to the crowd and they G up again, and then that took me extra 5, 10, 15 seconds that you needed.
Halfway there, there's three of you in top spot. It's going to be tough.
It's going to be interesting. It's going to be very interesting. The medal of the last event, I think the stones might split it, and the medal is going to be tough for everybody.
And these are the Atlas stones, an event steeped in mythology and dangerous too. Drop one of these on your big toe and your tap dancing career could be severely foreshortened. They weigh between 95 and 135 kilograms. You have to put them on their designated spots. And in case you're wondering, the guys are wearing steel-toed shoes because, you know, accidents can happen.
The third event is often make or break. For one or two, their dreams will end here.
And the final stone, weighing 21 stones, that's where it goes, the lowest part of the wall. And as John was saying, for Neil Elliott on the left-hand side and Paul Banks, this really is their last chance to make an impression on this competition in the third event.
On the right-hand lane, Paul Banks, England.
Good cheer there for Paul Banks from Slough. 6 feet and 19 stones with a 52-inch chest. Well, the first one shouldn't present them with any problems picking it up, but they've got to put it on the highest part of the wall, and that's 6 feet. Both together. Make sure it's steady on the top. We don't want it careering down the far side of the wall. Otherwise, they would have to go around and retrieve it. And Paul's going well. Neil Elliott just struggling with that second stone up on the shoulder. That is phenomenal strength. Now, the time at which these stones go on the wall is absolutely crucial in the event of a tie. Here's the third one, 115 kilograms, 17 and a half stones. Well, Neil has caught up just a little bit, but both men struggling here. Just a bit more. Come on, Scotland, they're shouting. Well, in terms of time, it's a 90-second time limit, and Paul Banks is just in the lead at the moment. He got his second stone on the wall faster than Neil Elliott. Oh, unlucky.
John!
Exhaustion as well is a factor. These guys are not really built for endurance.
Shoulder, Neil.
Oh, tremendous effort by Neil Elliott. He's had enough. The whistle hasn't gone, so Paul Banks is continuing. Or is he? I think that's it. So Paul Banks takes the lead, but it is early days yet.
Like I said in the beginning, I've always wanted to do this. Have me shot now.
You're going to tell me next you enjoyed that?
I did, actually. I nearly had it out of the stop, but I ran out of breath. I had to have a little breather for a little while.
Adam Townsend asking for some support. Gary Adams in the blue T-shirt.
Ready? On the whistle.
So Adam, on the left-hand side, is one of the men tied on 10 points. Oh, that first stone, he absolutely threw it up on his shoulder. That was tremendous. Having said that, he's having difficulty getting it on the wall now. He's just a shade under 6 feet tall. So Gary Adams catches Adam Townsend up. And still Graham Mullins and Brian Bell to go in this competition. That's a big mistake by Adam. And this could be one of Gary Adams' best performances so far. Well, Brian Bell, who goes in the next heat, he's done this event many, many times, and I think experience might tell here. Gary Adams on the third stone. Adam Townsend really struggling. He's resting that stone almost on his head. Ah, well, Gary failing there, just as Paul and Neil did on the third stone. I have seen one or two men get all five stones up, but they were very special athletes in the World's Strongest Man final. And Jukka Ahola, who managed that, is actually here at Alton Towers today watching. He may well give them a few tips as well. Now, if he can get this one up, he goes into the lead, as would Gary. That's it. So the timekeepers will confer to see who goes into the lead. I suspect Paul Banks is the fastest so far from the first heat. And indeed it is. Paul Banks 20.40, Gary Adams 28.44, and Adam Townsend over 50 seconds.
Yeah, I was looking forward to it, but I've never done the actual stones onto the blocks. Not if I'm picking stones up, just getting underneath them to get them on top. I just couldn't get myself underneath them to get them on top. So you learn, don't you, from your mistakes. Just got to win a medley now.
Well, Graham Mullins on the right-hand side and Brian Bell will not want to make any mistakes at this stage in the competition. Bell, very experienced at this event. Away we go. Don't expect blinding speed in terms of the running. This is all about guts and determination, and it's Bell who's away first. Oh, Mullins catches up so quickly. He's a very tall man, about 6 feet three. He just popped that first one on his shoulder as he does the second. So Brian Bell is quicker over the ground, but Mullins is finding this quite easy. Nobody has yet managed to get the third stone up. It's Bell and Mullins going head to head, and Mullins does it. Bell too, this is fantastic. So both of them guaranteed either first or second place in this third contest. And they could both be on their way to the final after this as well. Oh, Bell's dropped that one. The fourth stone weighing 20 stones exactly, 130 kilograms. And Mullins has got it. That is fantastic. Well, I think Graham Mullins has won this one. Brian Bell looks absolutely exhausted, and Mullins is having a good look just to see what's going on. He doesn't have to lift the fifth stone. He's ahead, and that is it. Well done to Graham Mullins. His second victory in a row, and that is so important. And Mr. Consistency, Brian Bell is in the points again.
I'm so pleased because I've never done the stones in this fashion before with the high platforms. Obviously the height suits me, but at this end we're all on the floor. It's a hell of a long way for me to go down. But when I got to the fourth one, I got it up. It felt good. Getting it up there felt good. And on the fifth one, I thought I'd just wait and see what Brian's doing. I didn't want to attempt it and waste any energy unless I had to.
He didn't have to. Graham Mullins, the only man to lift four stones. Brian Bell, the only man to lift three. And the way things are looking after three events, it really is a two-man race. Mullins and Bell almost certain to make it through to the final, unless... because things can go horribly wrong in the final event. And here we are, back in front of the castle, for a real test of strength. Three elements to our last event, the medley: lifting the dead weight, carrying the barrel, and flipping this massive tyre, 380 kilograms, that's more than 60 stone. Makes you tired just thinking about it. Well, the first heat was won by Neil Elliott, so here we are with the second. Two of these three will make it through to the final.
Adam Townsend, well, it would have to be a phenomenal display here by Adam if he's going to make it through to the final. Mathematically, it's possible, but really, Graham Mullins, the biggest man in this heat, who's won two events already, and Brian Bell look as though they're safe and sound. Adam Townsend enjoying the experience, though, that's for sure, and he'll be back next year. 200 kilograms, this weight, and they've got to run with it. Can you believe it? Here we go.
bit of protection around the knees. Oh my goodness, Adam Townsend, an early problem there. Mullins in the lead. And then this huge tyre. Bell and Townsend together. A bit of pride at stake here. Not just the point of going through to the final, but I'm sure Bell or Mullins would like to win the heat. A little psychological edge there. And there's Jukka Ahola, world's strongest man 2 years ago. He's one of the marshals here, just checking for safety, that that tyre doesn't fall down and hurt the athlete. It's Brian Bell in the lead. Mullins has slowed down a little bit. Bell and Townsend together. Both coming back now for the last barrel. If Bell wins this event, he's won the overall heat. And Bell gets it. Scotland are in the final. Adam Townsend will have to wait another 12 months for his chance. And the way the clock is ticking, Mullins will finish in third place. He guarantees his place in the final.
Let's talk to the winner first, Brian. Many congratulations. You didn't make any mistakes at all, did you?
No, I couldn't afford to make any mistakes, but I had to break my consistency and get first this time.
And through to the final, you've got to be delighted with that.
I'm delighted to be in the top eight now in Britain, yeah. Probably a little bit of mental problem because I knew I was safe. All I had to do was put the block over the line and I was still through to the finals. But you don't do that. You come here to put the show on for the crowd. So I thought I'd go for it.
But it was always going to be enough, as Graham knew, even though Adam Townsend did really well to manage to split the big two. And all that means is that we now know the first two finalists, Scotland's Bell and South Yorkshire's Mullins, one step nearer being Britain's strongest man.
Well, Brian, congratulations on winning that heat. Just before we finish, though, there's one little test we'd like you to do, and this is a test your strength machine. Just show us how powerful you really are. So, grand score of 10 for Brian. Here, though, we have Doreen, who's a grandma from Maryport in Cumbria. Just show Brian, you know, where he's going wrong. You've got that expert technique. Give it a good whack. Go on.
Enough.
93. I rest my case.
And John's back with more hopefuls tomorrow evening at the same time. Stay here with BBC One, where the bank holiday workout continues for British hopefuls en route to the Sydney Olympics next.
At Alton Towers, where 24 men are trying to be Britain's strongest man and win the Energizer Battery Trophy. They can all lift a washing machine, that's easy. But how many of them have been inside one?
So the 24 men are all competing for the Energizer Battery Trophy, and two are through to the final already after the first heat. Brian Bell and Graham Mullins, waiting to see who will join them in the final. And in Heat 2, all human life is here. A chef, a gym owner, a TV researcher, a joiner, a mechanic and a prison officer. Glenn Ross is 28 and he's already Ireland's strongest man. Rod Dixon's 25, his gym is called Samson and Delilah. Colin Bryce, just 24, the youngest man in this Heat 2.
Stuart Murray, 27, one of Britain's representatives in last year's World's Strongest Man. Alan Turner, 42, the oldest man in the competition. And John Kiss, he's 30, he lists his favourite food as anything.
Well, this event's called the Farmer's Walk, simple enough. Pick up these two oxygen bottles, combined weight getting on for 500 pounds, carry them 40 metres, put them down, and then your arms drop off.
And we'll start in the main square in front of the castle here at Alton Towers with your commentator, Paul Dickinson.
Great atmosphere here this morning at Alton Towers as John Kiss, the first competitor, comes out. Johnny Kiss from Hayes in Middlesex. Prison officer, learned his trade in strongman competitions by working with former World's Strongest Man, Gary Taylor. And this is Colin Bryce from Glasgow. Island Games expert, but a novice in these sort of strongman events. Huge Glenn Ross, the heaviest man in Britain's Strongest Man this year, 180 kilograms. But what sort of speed has he got? Rob Dixon. Comparative novice as well, from Wigington in Yorkshire, owns his own gym, so gets plenty of time to train. Stuart Murray, the shortest man in the competition, but look at those arms, absolutely massive. And finally, Alan Turner, the oldest man in the competition. Alan, coming from Consett in County Durham.
I feel a little bit under pressure because I've heard a few people have put me down for favourite, they say, which I don't like. I'm just going to play my own game. I've got to play my own game. And hopefully I should do okay.
How well do you know this event?
Quite well. The ones I've used before have been a little bit higher off the ground, so it's more like a deadlift to start off with, then go. Just very explosive. There's no time. Just give it all you've got. That's all I'm going to do.
First of all, you've got to get it up. Get it up and get stable, and then just short steps. You overstride, your leg will go, you'll collapse. And that's your worst nightmare, because you've got to pick it up again.
Sounds fun.
Why am I doing it? I don't know. Yeah.
Referee Dougie Edmonds in charge, as always. Johnny Kiss on this side. And here we go, and I tell you what, lifting these cylinders, well, it's like lifting a full refrigerator in each hand. They're absolutely massive. And it's Glenn Ross who gets there first. Well, we questioned his mobility down the course, but he's proving he can move as well as look very strong indeed. But Stuart Murray leads. The Scot has gone into the lead, chased by Glenn Ross and Alan Turner on the far side. Murray wins it, Ross in second. But who's going to get third? Alan Turner gets it on the far side. Well done to him. Those huge arms being put to good use today for Murray. Now then, who can get fourth place? It's Rob Dixon ahead of Colin Bryce, but here comes Colin Bryce. He's going to go past him. Or is he? Yes, he does. Bryce in fourth place. Rob Dixon really struggling, but where is Johnny Kiss? There he is in the red T-shirt. I think both of them will have given up. Johnny Kiss finding it desperately difficult. He's still having a go. And it's all over now. Johnny Kiss's first ever Britain's Strongest Man event in sixth place.
To be quite honest, it felt quite light. I've done heavier.
Quite light? Are you serious?
Yeah, seriously, yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, let's have a look at these big arms that helped you along the way. Fantastic.
Anyway, boys, I'll tell you, if I have a weak event in strength, it's a farmer's walk for distance. So I'm absolutely thrilled. I've worked hard on it in the last few months, trying to get my speed up, and it's come good today.
So less than a second in it, but Stuart Murray came out on top, although Glenn Ross is clearly in confident mood. Now, there are lots of trees at Alton Towers, some of them bigger than others.
Well, lifting logs is a pretty serious business. You can jerk and you can push press this, but you can't dip or split it. I thought you ought to know that. And it's 380 kilograms, which in anybody's terms is a very big log.
John Inverdale, absolutely right. The biggest log I think any of these men have ever seen, let alone lifted. And it's Johnny Kiss who's going to try first. It's on a pivot, so the actual weight they're feeling is around about 110 kilos. That's about 17 stones. You've got to have phenomenally strong arms to do this. So referee Dougie Edmonds says get away, and he hasn't counted that first one, I think because of an excessive dip on his legs. So Johnny Kiss, that's four repetitions. And this guy who trains with former World's Strongest Man, Welshman Gary Taylor, both prison officers, and you wouldn't mess with these two guys, would you? Johnny Kiss going pretty well, finishing last in the first event, so he needs very good points here if he's going to stay in the hunt for a place in the final. This is good from Johnny Kiss. He's gone up to 12. Can he squeeze one more out? Oh, he's come to a resting position on his shoulders. Come on, just one more. That is it. But I think he's enjoyed this event. A much more confident event for Johnny Kiss.
Yeah. Pressing's more my sort of forte. From the powerlifting background, I enjoy this a lot more, especially from this morning.
Rob Dixon.
Get ready.
A phenomenal target by Johnny Kiss that he's got to go for. Well, referee Dougie Edmonds has given him that one. Just a little bit of a dip with the knees. I suppose he's letting him get away with that. But imagine 16 and a half stones. If you had a 16 and a half stone man and you try to push him over your head as many times as possible, that's how difficult it is. The balance is crucial too. And he's going well. 12 the target. He's equal to it. And he goes into the lead. Fifth in the last event. So this looks much, much better for Rob Dixon. Dixon, the Yorkshireman. Oh, he's faltered there, but 16 repetitions, a big smile on his face. He's done very well indeed. A little bit fazed by the experience, perhaps, but that was phenomenal.
Well, two of the guys found the going really tough. Colin Bryce managed only 8 repetitions, and things were even harder for Alan Turner, just the 6 from him.
Now the big man, Glenn Ross, second in the first event, so has already got a valuable 5 points.
Get ready!
And I really do think Glenn Ross fancies his chances here. Oh, look at that, it's so, so easy. No dip of the legs, just shoulder and arm strength. Well, we questioned his speed in the first event, there was nothing wrong there. I wonder how his endurance is. 180 kilograms he weighs, and there's his wife, a newborn baby. He's got tremendous support, and already he's a great favorite with the crowd. Now remember, he's chasing the lead of 16 repetitions by Rob Dixon. Goes past Johnny Kiss. There's only Stuart Murray to go in this event, and Glenn Ross, can he get the last one? Yes, he can. He goes into the lead. He's going to go for even more, to make it even more difficult for Stuart Murray, and he's done it. That is incredible. 18 repetitions. I don't know whether anybody has ever done that before. Glenn Ross is going to be tough to beat, that is for sure.
I found difficult even just to get underneath it to start it. But once I was in, wasn't too bad. And I was very pleased.
I still think though that Stuart fancies his chances in this one.
Well, Stuart is a very good shoulder presser. Very, very good. He's improved a lot in the log this year. And I'm thinking on the way, I'm sort of watching, we'll watch him.
I'm sure he will be watching him very carefully. Stuart Murray. Well under 6 feet tall, but those arms of his are bigger than most people's legs.
Down, Stuart.
They're way, way over 20 inches around the circumference of his biceps and his triceps. Murray from Colside in Dumfries in Scotland. Slowly but steadily. Rob Dixon in second place with 16 repetitions. Now then, Johnny Kiss has got 12, Colin Bryce 8 and Alan Turner 6. Murray is going well. Glenn Ross was a little faster, but that doesn't matter. Oh, he's struggling a wee bit. I think Glenn Ross has got it in the bag. But still, the Irishman cheering on the Scotsman. That's it. That is a big surprise. Stuart Murray is going to finish down in fourth place. Northern Ireland gets it through Glenn Ross. Ross's first victory of this second heat.
So disappointing for Stuart Murray, just the 11 repetitions there. Glenn Ross and Rob Dixon out on their own. And all that means that the Irishman is now in the box seat at the halfway stage of this Heat 2.
1 point behind the leader going into that event, 2 points ahead now. That's pretty good.
Well, today I had to do the business today, you know, and I've done it, you know, because tomorrow is a... for the fit boys, but like I said, I've been working on my fitness, and I've already surprised them this year, my fitness, how fit I am. But it was a crowd that done it, I think, today, the cheering and everything, fabulous setting all the tires and that, and I'm enjoying the competition.
Well, this is Yvonne Ross, and her husband's called Glenn, and he's in this competition, and he's very big, and this is his sweatshirt, and we're both in it. So if you're sort of buying clothes for him, you can't just sort of nip down to the local, you know, mainstream store and just say, I want 4 shirts, can you?
No, not at all. Because at home, nobody knows really what a big man is. A big man at home is like a 56-inch chest. Glenn's like 64-inch chest. I have to send away for catalogues over the water, Scotland, England. But at home, it's nearly impossible.
What about around the thighs and sort of trouser size?
Very, very big trousers. I can't remember exactly his leg measurement, but that's like the biggest part of him.
What is the best thing about being married to somebody of his build?
He makes you look thinner when you walk on his side. He's great for carrying luggage too, so he is, and moving furniture and stuff like that. But no, the really good thing about it is getting to see the world and coming to all these competitions and staying in really nice hotels and having a bit of fun.
And you're pretty proud of him?
Oh, I am. Dead proud of him, so I am.
Excellent.
Yeah.
How are we going to get out of this, do you think?
I don't
Who gets out first? Maybe we're bound together forever.
I think Glenn might have something to say about that.
From a sweater to more sweating. Back to the action, and can Glenn Ross hang on to his lead here in the courtyard? This is a new event for Britain's strongest man, the loading race. Barrels, sacks, anchors, chains, put them all on the wall.
All black, Alan Turner, England.
Alan Turner on the right-hand side. A third place in the first event, and last in the last event. Colin Bryce needs to win this one if he's got any hope at all of making it through to the final. Come to that, he's probably got to win the last one too.
Ready? On the whistle.
So here we go, the sack weighing 60 kilos, just short of 10 stones, and both men sprinting. Bryce is first. Alan Turner, the oldest man in the competition, so I wonder what his endurance is like. Then, the barrel, 75 kilos. It's not so much the weight, it's how awkward it is. This is a real thinking game. Alan Turner deciding to go sideways with that log. It's very, very awkward. Weighs over 16 stones, and Bryce has thought it out a little better. But Turner is still in the lead. Now the anchor. Weighs 100 kilos, but look at it. The shape is very, very awkward. Bryce is behind at the moment. Alan Turner having his best event so far, and now this awesome chain. 190 kilos. Over 30 stones, and all of it has got to go onto the platform, and this is where Turner is failing. Bryce has got it 59 seconds or thereabouts. It could be even quicker. Turner's still got a bit of work to do, but that was phenomenal by Colin Bryce on the far side. He's got to get the whole thing on. There it is, 1 minute 12 seconds, and Turner is absolutely exhausted.
I think that'll be quite a hard time to beat, but we'll see.
Now, athleticism is obviously very important. You're a bit of an athlete. What sort of training should you be doing for something like this?
Oh, you know, any kind of aerobic work, fitness work. I do a lot of sprint training, about 90 seconds, and that was just perfect. Just hitting the wall at the last moment there.
But this could be a big comeback for you.
6 points in this, 6 points in the next. I'll go through his first place.
Well, I think if Johnny Kiss hit the wall, he'd probably knock it over. Stuart Murray as well. An important event for both of these fellas now. Johnny Kiss on the left-hand side, Stuart Murray about the same height, but Johnny Kiss a couple of stones heavier. What a fantastic target set by Colin Bryce, 57.31 seconds. Very quick for both men, on the sack, now the barrel. Johnny Kiss going well here. Stuart Murray just about a second behind. Now then, this is one of the most awkward objects. Stuart Murray really has got incredibly strong arms. Coming up to the half minute, 27 seconds left if either of them want to go into the lead. Now, which way are we going to get this up? Sideways or head on? Stuart Murray catching up just a little bit. It's Scotland at the moment, ahead of the Middlesex man. Oh, this is a real stumbling block for Johnny Kiss, and Stuart Murray is outside of Colin Bryce's time. So Bryce still in the lead, with only two men to go after this. Now come on, Stuart, you've got to get that final link of the chain up. And has he got it? Yes, he has. Stuart Murray round about 72 seconds. Come to think of it, that was Alan Turner's time as well, so the stopwatches here are going to be critical. Oh, Johnny Kiss, well, it was a valiant effort with the first three objects, but the anchor and the chain have proved very difficult indeed. The whistle goes, time has run out for Johnny Kiss. Oh my goodness, he's in all sorts of trouble.
Scotsmen are pretty good at this. We've got Colin Bryce in first place, but you're in second now. So yeah. not a bad event for you.
No, I thought I'd do okay at that. I just need to keep in front of Rob Dixon. So I hope my time will be faster than his. We'll have to wait and see.
The final pairing, big Glenn Ross on this side. Weighs what? He's getting on for 30 stones against Rob Dixon.
For me in particular, it's a bit of a thinking game. They're not all the same objects, as you'll see, they're all different ones, so I've got to think what I'm doing, not just speed, it's think as well.
Now, how are you going to approach this one?
Just go all out for it, really. I'm usually very good at loading events, as long as they're heavy, and there's a couple of heavy things here today, so hopefully it should be my foray, and I'll go out and win it, you know.
You've still got to convince me you're built for endurance, but there's a lot of endurance in this one, isn't there?
Yeah, just watch and see.
Well, thank I'm not going to argue with Glenn Ross. He's too big for that. Ross on the right-hand side. Oh, almost a false start there by Rob Dixon. He's so eager to get this event underway. I think he fancies his chances here. Dixon by a whisker from Glenn Ross. Now the barrel. 75 kilos, nearly 14 stones. Glenn Ross is a few seconds behind already. Dixon is going well, the Yorkshireman. Oh, Glenn Ross, now then. Dixon said it was a thinking man's game, and that was a good move by Glenn Ross. That was very quick with the pole. And this is where Johnny Kiss had all sorts of problems. Has Rob Dixon done enough thinking? Yes, he has. This is fast. Colin Bryce's time, a 57.31, could be under threat, and he knows it. Glenn Ross is going pretty well. I take back all I said about his endurance. That doesn't seem to be a factor at the moment. And Colin Bryce has won it. Oh, it was so close. but this is Rob Dixon's best result so far, just outside 60 seconds. Glenn Ross having a bit of a problem, and he's got it, but that is a slow time for the Irishman. He could be down in about fifth place. And actually, the doctor is going towards him just to make sure the big man is okay.
Well, victory for Colin Bryce puts him right back in it, but Glenn Ross, down in fifth, must be a worried man with one event to go, because any two of the top four can now make it through to the final.
Now, I'm sure you've done your homework. It's only a win that's important here, isn't it?
Yeah, I woke up this morning, I needed two firsts. I've got one, I'm going to get my second, hopefully. If I don't, well, that's... no excuses.
You're not going to be watching any of the other competitors, though. It's just eyeballs out all the way.
Yeah, I'm going to be in the first part of the heat, and I'm going to set the running. So hopefully they'll have to catch me, and they'll make the mistakes.
So this is the medley event. Carrying a weight, flipping tyres, and loading barrels. And with just 2 points separating the top four, anything could happen here.
It's absolutely incredible what has happened overnight. Colin Bryce way, way down after the first two events. That victory has brought him right back into this competition. Alan Turner right next to him, then Johnny Kiss. But it's all about this man. If he can win this event, he's got a real chance of going through to the final.
The whistle!
200 kilograms, first of all, and Bryce is away. The Scotsman, whose father used to be the Scottish record holder for the hammer, went to the Commonwealth Games, and his son has followed in his footsteps, throwing heavy things around as though they were feathers. Johnny Kiss, too, is going well. Alan Turner's got some work to do. He's in third place at the moment. Bryce on his way with the first barrel. Two more to go. It's all about the stopwatch now. And three big men will go in the second heat. Now, come on, Colin. You've got a real chance. Johnny Kiss just outside 40 seconds. Alan Turner struggling a wee bit. Bryce is finished. Just over 47 seconds. Fantastic time again. And he's beaten the other two by a mile. Johnny Kiss has still got one more barrel to go. Alan Turner, too. There'll be a huge cheer for these two entertainers when they're finished. Johnny Kiss has finished, 64 seconds or thereabouts. Great experience for him. I'm sure he'll be another one who'll be back next year, bigger and stronger than ever. Giving Alan Turner all the encouragement. Oh, these last few steps must be agony, but he's done it. Colin Bryce was incredible, though.
Well done, Alan. 47 seconds. That is phenomenal.
That had to be phenomenal. Rob's very good at this. So, I think Rob could do it yet, though, so I haven't counted my chickens yet.
Rob, you obviously saw what Colin did. It was a phenomenal time, wasn't it?
Impressive. Very impressive, yeah.
So what do you have to do now to make it through to the final?
To beat him. I think I have to beat him. Count back, he'll beat me.
I know exactly what I've got to do, but I'm not giving it away at the moment.
You're not?
I don't need to beat Colin's time. I know who I've got to beat to get through.
Who is it?
Well, we'll see.
Well, in terms of Stuart Murray's efforts here, he's got to stay ahead of Rob Dixon, that's for sure. Former world's strongest man, Yuko Ahola, one of the spectators, and there's Jamie Reeves, another former world's strongest man. There's some big fellas here. But this guy is the biggest, Glenn Ross. This event is absolutely crucial. It's all about mathematics.
Ready.
And the stopwatch now.
Take a grip on the whistle.
Here we go. Oh, Glenn Ross stumbling. He's back on his feet and going well. And on the far side, Rob Dixon going well too. Stuart Murray in third place at the moment. Rob Dixon the first to lift that tyre. And Glenn Ross the first to flip it. Dixon has got to stay ahead of Glenn Ross and Stuart Murray. Effectively, they've all got to beat Colin Bryce to make sure. Here goes Glenn Ross. He's on first. Stuart Murray second. Rob Dixon third. This is a fabulous climax to Heat 2 of Britain's Strongest Man. It's so, so close. Here goes Glenn Ross. Surely he's in the final now. I don't think Rob Dixon or Stuart Murray will make it. Colin Bryce has won the final event, and he will go through with Glenn Ross.
There's room for a fat one in this final.
Well, it's a brave man who would call Glenn Ross fat, that's for sure.
Well, a good day for the fat man, but it was always going to be tight. Colin Bryce's marvellous final day, though, meant that he was the man of the moment.
I wouldn't have turned up if I hadn't thought I had a chance. Said I was the dark horse, and I was probably a little darker than I really let on. But it's everything's fallen my way today.
But you're through to the final. You won the heat. That's the most important thing.
Outright. Well, that's good, isn't it? Going to win the final now. It's all big stuff for a big man.
So Ireland's strongest man through to the final of Britain's strongest man, along with Colin Bryce. Huge disappointment for Stuart Murray and Rob Dixon, which means that we have four finalists so far, two Scotsmen, an Irishman and a Yorkshireman. So we're halfway through our quest to find Britain's strongest man here at Alton Towers. Four down, four more to find. Hope to see you again next time.
And that next heat is tomorrow night at 7 here on BBC One. Next tonight, the tough guys of Albert Square are looking a little bit shaky. In the Dale.
Where 24 men are fighting it out for the Energizer Battery Trophy to be Britain's strongest man. One thing's for sure, there's no buffet on this train. I mean, your tea would go everywhere!
We're halfway through now, and already four men have booked their places in the final. In the second heat, it looks certain that Scotland's Stuart Murray and Ireland's Glenn Ross were going to be the two to qualify. But with a late surge when he won both the final events, Colin Bryce made it through. Which means that these are the first four finalists, Brian Bell and Colin Bryce from Scotland, Glenn Ross from Ireland, Graham Mullins from Yorkshire. And here we go with Heat 3, a brewer, a meat porter, a motorcycle trader, a joiner, a security guard and an engineer. Bill Pittock is 36, a veteran of the World's Strongest Man competition in the Bahamas. Lee Bowers is 32. He was in the World's Strongest event in Morocco last year. Jason Young, 30 years old. He's put a lot of weight on, specifically for this event. Robert Howes, 34, a fan of Benny Hill and Homer Simpson, but this is going to be no laughing matter. Welshman Christian Clay is 23, the youngest man in Britain's Strongest Man. And this is Mark Griffith, 26, the UK powerlifting champion of 1998. On familiar territory, because each heat is starting off here in the main square in front of the castle at Alton Towers, and we'll begin with the carrion drag, and commentary as ever comes from Paul Dickinson.
All the athletes being introduced to the crowd. Christian Clay, probably the most inexperienced athlete here today, but a real trier, the man from Pontypridd.
Lane 5, Robert Howe.
Robert Howe from Hull, 6'3", weighs about 19 stones. Very fit man, he does a lot of running.
Lane 4, Jason Young.
Jason Young from Rossshire, just short of 20 stones and a very good Highland Games exponent indeed.
Lane three, Bill Pittock.
Bill Pittock, probably one of the most experienced men here. He's been out of action for just a little while through injury, but has competed in World's Strongest Man before.
Lane two, Lee Bowers.
As has Lee Bowers from Colne in Lancashire. 6 feet and 20 stones of solid muscle.
Lane one, Mark Griffiths.
And finally, Mark Griffiths from Derbyshire, a very experienced weightlifter. He's won English titles before.
Yeah, I'm very nervous at the minute. I haven't had that for 2 years. I've been out of the lawnmower for 2 years. I'm just trying to make a comeback now, so everyone seems to think I'm favourite. I don't know why.
Well, it's a tough event, but it looks doable.
Can you win it?
Yeah.
I can win.
Well, we shall see. Lee Bowers drawn next to Bill Pittock, the two most experienced men here. Dougie Edmonds gets them underway. Robert Howe is going well, and so is Bill Pittock in the middle. He's absolutely flying at the moment, comes back for the sack. And when they come back, the combined weight of over 500 pounds is going to be a real test of strength and endurance. Bill Pittock has got a massive lead so far. So here we go. Robert Howe in second place. Jason Young's going pretty well. Lee Bowers beginning his drag now. Mark Griffiths in last place, but he is the lightest man in the competition. That's Christian Clay. It's Bill Pittock by about 3 metres at the moment from Jason Young. Oh, the man from Northamptonshire, surely he's going to win this first event. Lee Bowers just in second place, ahead of Jason Young. And Pittock gets first place. A very good performance. He's back. Lee Bowers in second place now. Jason Young fallen over. Robert Howe's there, so is Christian Clay. But Jason Young just gets it. Robert Howe's got about half a metre to go, and I think Christian Clay finished just ahead of him. They're all flat out. Mark Griffiths still down the course. He's only about 17 stones, so he's found this very tough indeed. What a first event. That was brilliant.
Tell you what, I'd rather be at home having a cup of tea.
I think years ago it was more strong man. I think now it's strength athlete, looking at Yuka and the Finns.
I hate to say this though, but Lee Bowers was catching you towards the end.
My legs blowing, I see him. So I won that one.
Everybody's been saying this is an easy heat, but there's no such thing as easy in strongman.
Bill Pittock's going to be tough to beat, though, isn't he?
Yeah. That's not to say I'm not going to beat him, though.
Tough at the top between Pittock and Bowers. A really tough event, though, for Mark Griffiths, who didn't manage to complete the course. Alton Towers isn't just about stomach-churning rides, and we cross the gardens and the lake for the second event, and this is about going through the paint barrier.
Well, never mind big men, let's talk big numbers here. Like this car weighs 2,840 pounds, and at the point where they have to pick it up at the back, we're talking in excess of 50 stone. So next time your car breaks down, don't call the AA or the RAC. Call these guys. They'll carry it home for you.
Mark Griffiths, England.
So here comes young Mark Griffiths. The Derby man really has got a lot of work to do. Just a single point from that first event. He's really psyched up for this one. And as always, Jamie Reeves helps them get strapped on. The grip, of course, is so important.
Stand by.
And as John was saying, they really do have to go through the pain barrier.
Loose.
Dougie Edmonds in control of the event. Here we go. Well, goodness knows where it hurts in the body. I suspect it's everywhere. The legs, the back, the arms, the shoulders. And Mark is really gritting his teeth. Anything over 30 seconds in this event is absolutely amazing. 50 stones of weight. Bearing down on the hands. The arms must be burning now. He's over 30. This is a good performance by Mark Griffiths, and he's gone. Oh, yes, 34.5 seconds. He was headed off the stage there to oblivion. Good performance, though.
The last competition, I did rubbish and I was upset with myself. This one, I was determined to hold on no matter what. I could feel my whole body trembling, but I wasn't going to give in. I thought, Mike, you've got to really go for it this time. I could hear the timer going 10, 20, 13, it was 30-something before I dropped it.
Around about 34.
So, yeah, it's nice to try and get back up that table.
Robert Howe this time. Very tall man, so I suspect this initial lift is going to be quite difficult. One of the strangest things he ever lifted, his girlfriend's father, sister and brother. So he's obviously pretty strong. Here we go. He's a good entertainer as well. We've had a lot of fun with this guy over the last few days. Good result though by Mark Griffiths. 34 seconds to beat. He's shaking already. You've got to stay in control to try and blank out the pain. It almost looks as though his arms are being pulled out of their sockets. Going towards 30 seconds. And he's got 30. Needs a couple more. He's gone into the lead. What a good result for Robert Howe. Oh, my goodness. He's almost bending at the waist. Oh, I hope he doesn't turn green and turn into the Incredible Hulk. He's soaking up this atmosphere and the crowd are absolutely loving it, and it's a phenomenal time. Can he go past 1 minute? Yes, he can. Oh, he's finished at 61 seconds. Absolutely incredible. And Jamie Reeves there, he's a former World's Strongest Man. I bet he's never been kissed like that before. That was tremendous by Robert Howe. And he enjoyed every minute of it. Amazing performance.
Yeah, I'm not the strongest man here, but big heart, have a laugh.
Now,
you know, you do your best.
Big question though, can anybody beat that?
I don't know. It's all on the day. I mean, I've set my target. The two big boys are to come, so you just never know, do you?
Brilliant performance. Yeah. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Well done.
Rock and roll!
Well, he was smiling, but the young Welshman Christian Clay certainly wasn't. Just 25 seconds from him. And it was tough going too for Jason Young. 34 seconds, and he just missed out on overtaking Mark Griffiths.
Lee Bowers, England.
So only Lee Bowers here and Bill Pittock to go. 61.44 seconds by Robert Howe. But Lee Bowers, he's a phenomenal athlete. Believe it or not, he ran in the English Schools Athletics Championships once over 100 metres, and he came away with a silver medal. He's put on a bit of weight since then, though.
Take on!
Oh, a little bit of staggering at the start, but he's rock steady now. He bows from Lancashire. He's used to lifting. He's a meat porter. And he lifts sides of beef every day of his life. A couple of years ago, in World's Strongest Man, he beat world record holder Gerrit Badenhorst from South Africa in the deadlift competition. So he is phenomenally strong. Gritting his teeth, trying to block out the pain. Just look how those straps are cutting into his wrists. Well, he's gone ahead of all the rest. Now he's chasing Robert Howe's lead. Very broad across the shoulder, arms over 20 inches around. 50 seconds and he's gone. 51 seconds, Robert Howe is still in the lead and there's only Bill Pittock to go.
A minute is a hell of a target to go for anybody, isn't it?
It is. Rob Howe did very, very well at that. Yeah. But it felt all right. Felt okay.
Bill, do you see it as a big advantage going last because of that win in the first event?
Yes. Yeah, very. Yeah, it's a case of who's got the most stamina and pain threshold, I think. So
that's your pain threshold at the moment.
Pretty good, actually.
Well, in about a minute's time, we shall see. Bill Pittock, he's won national competitions in strongman 3 times before. tremendously experienced. Comes from West Hunsbury in Northamptonshire.
Are you ready?
Shade under 6 feet tall, nearly 20 stones in weight, and obviously phenomenally strong. He says yes. Lee Bowers, 51 seconds plus. But the lead is still that 61 seconds by Robert Howe. Pittock, 6 maximum points in the first event. Looks pretty comfortable at the moment. The first time he ever entered a strongman competition, he won it. He got a taste for it, and since then he's got better and better. Over 30 seconds now. Tremendous performance again by Bill Pittock, but I think he's losing his grip. He's only just hanging on by those lifting straps now. Chasing Lee Bowers, 51 seconds. It's so, so close. Oh, it's gone. Over 49 seconds, but good enough for third place. Lee Bowers is second place in a row, but there was really only one man in that competition, and that was Robert Howe.
Bill, what happened?
Had a blowout.
Well, what it means is you finished in third place, you're equal now at the halfway stage with Lee.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
You're happy with that?
That's fine, yeah. Yeah, it's two events to go. Just want to qualify, so first or second will do me.
So Robert Howe, Hull's finest, was top dog at the deadlift, giving himself a real chance of qualifying for the final. And at the halfway stage, it looks as though it's Perm 2 from 3. Will it be Pittock, Bowers or Howe that makes it through? Well, what are you about to have for your supper? Well, these guys in the Britain's Strongest Man competition are big guys, and they eat big meals. But just how big? Well, during the course of an average day, you will consume food that eats up 2,000 calories. They talk in terms of between 7 and 8,000, which means this much food. 10 huge meals every day, 10 bowls of soup, 10 prawns and peppers, 10 chicken legs, 10 kebabs, 10 portions of fish. Heaven knows how many pounds worth of potatoes, carrots, beans, rice, broccoli. And as if that's not enough, look at these puddings, chocolate eclairs, all sorts of gooey cakes, cheesecakes, and roughly 18 bread rolls. Liquid intake is crucially important as well, and one of them even starts every single day with 6 pints of milk down in one. If I start my soup about now, I'll finish this lot by the third millennium. Five stones, 5 big stones, no rolling allowed. They weigh between 95 and 135 kilograms and have to be put in their special designated spots, one after the other. But drop one on your big toe and Alex Ferguson won't be asking you for a trial. Jolly boating weather beneath glorious blue skies and a big crowd building up for this third event of the third heat. Lee Bowers and Bill Pittock go back a long way. They're great friends and great rivals too. Right now locked in a real battle for first place.
Yeah, that's the way it should be. We're quite a long rivalry between me and Bill.
We're all Gordons. We've been in this position long before, haven't we? Plenty of times before. So.
Yeah, so I'm used to it and Bill's used to it.
Yeah. It's a bit of a jinx on me though. In the last competitions he said it's between me and Bill. And the lad who's beyond us won it, so...
So from now on, I
learned to say that.
It's not over till it's over.
Anything can happen.
Well, those two guys will be on the platform a little later. First of all, it's Christian Clay on the right-hand side, the young Welshman, up against Jason Young from Rossshire in Scotland. Christian Clay used to be a national archer, believe it or not. I hope his aim with these stones is pretty good, otherwise they'll go tumbling over the back. First of all, the lightest stone. Over 14 and a half stones, and up it goes. Jason Young carrying it slightly higher than Christian Clay. Both men not very experienced at this level of competition. And as we've seen in the previous heats, experience does count. Jason Young and Christian Clay getting those long arms around the stone. Oh, Jason Young, a bit of a slip there. A chance for Christian Clay to catch up. The second stone is on, and the stopwatch will record the times. Each stoner up there, and Jason Young has got problems. And the doctor goes rushing on. I'm not quite sure what happened there, But Jason Young is on the deck. Now then, Christian Clay, oblivious to that. Young is back up on his feet, but really struggling here. A phenomenal effort by Jason Young, and he's going to get the third stone up, or is he? Yes, he does. That is fantastic. A real gutsy effort by the Scotsman. Christian Clay, just with the two stones up. He's taller than Jason Young, and he gets it just.
You've got 15 seconds. Hands underneath.
Both competitors being told that the 90-second time limit is on its way. Jason Young is absolutely exhausted. It's been a phenomenal performance by him, but he's finished, and so is Christian Clay.
I thought I could do four stones here, but the first ones are just so high. You gotta pick it up on your chest, and then you gotta like press it. And it's just so high, it's unbelievable.
Bill Piddock and Mark Griffiths to go next. Mark Griffiths, the lightest man in this heat, just weighs about 17 and a half stones compared with Bill Piddock's solid 20 stones. And both of them striding out there purposefully. They've both had a chance to practice this. But the competition is where it gets very, very serious. Bill Piddock is away the fastest. Mark Griffiths already struggling with that first stone. Oh, it's gone over the back. What does he do now? He's got to go and get it. So a chance for Mark Griffiths to take advantage. This is incredible. I've never seen anything like this before. That is Jukka Ahola, a former world's strongest man himself. That's within the rules. But Bill Piddock has got that first stone to do all over again. Oh, well, he's gone ahead of Mark Griffiths, but a bit of drama within the first few seconds. He's lost a lot of time. Jason Young got his third stone up in 59.85 seconds, and Mark Griffiths is really struggling. He might even have an injury. He's holding his shoulder. Oh, Mark Griffiths has definitely got problems. Now, what about the time for Bill Piddock? We'll have to wait and see. I think it's quite quick. And Mark Griffiths is away, straight away, off to see the doctor. Now, can Bill Piddock get the fourth stone up? There's still Lee Bowers to go and Robert Howe. So two tough competitors yet to come. This fourth stone would be phenomenal, but Bill Piddock says he's had enough. He's holding his arm too, so maybe a little suggestion of an injury. And that could be bad news for the last event.
That was a joke. Everyone's struggling to get it on the first thing. I threw it over the top.
I've never seen that before.
I don't know. Too much power, I think. But I suffered a small injury.
What have you done?
I tore some muscle fibers. My voice there. Nothing major.
It could make it difficult, though, in the last event, couldn't it?
Well, my arm. Could do, yeah, and tire. But I'll hang in there. Got a few hours yet. Got to qualify. Yeah.
Went towards the rock, feeling confident. I more or less jerked it from what the doctor said and tore some muscle fibre off the ligament itself. Of course, when I got to the wall, I was trying to push it. I had all the power on the left-hand side, but the right-hand side of the shoulder, I had nothing there to put the rock up.
Are we going to see you on the start line for the last event?
I don't think so, no.
Now, that's tough on Mark Griffiths in his first Britain's Strongest Man competition. Worrying time, too, for Bill Piddock. So it's all up to Lee Bowers on the right-hand side and Robert Howe. Phenomenal performance by Robert Howe in the last event. He won by miles. Here we go, a little gentle jog to the start. Up it goes. Oh, Lee Bowers threw it up on his shoulder. Robert Howe's a very tall man, so this shouldn't be a problem, but he almost dropped it. Both together on the first stone. Now the jogging stopped, I'm not surprised. They've got to conserve energy. There's plenty of time to get all these stones up. But endurance is playing a major factor here, and that was easier than the first stone for Lee Bowers. Now, come on, Robert. You did brilliantly in the last event. He was certainly very confident coming onto the platform here for event number three. Lee Bowers the third stone up in the fastest time so far, so he goes into the lead. Can he do stone number four? Nobody's managed it yet. Not even Bill Piddock, and in actual fact, Bill Piddock injured himself trying, and he's done it. Lee Bowers wins this event. And Robert Howe has got a stone up as well. That is number three for him. So the man from Hull, well, he said he wasn't the strongest man here, but surely he's got plenty of guts and determination. Now, can Bowers do number five? He needn't bother. He's actually won it, but I think he wants to do it for his own self-satisfaction. I don't think he can. 6 points for Lee Bowers. And that is it. Robert Howe being told to put it down. Ah, unlucky. That is Lee Bowers' first victory in Britain's Strongest Man this year.
You wanted that fifth stone, didn't you?
Yes, I did, yeah. It will come. A bit more bad at work. Perhaps it was a little bit silly going for the fifth one, but it's strong, man. You've got to do it.
Well, four stones was enough for the 6 points for Lee Bowers. Bill Piddock, despite hurling that stone over the back of the wall, still good enough for five and second place. And those two are well clear of the pack going into the final event. Almost all over, bar the choral recital, as the medley finale loomed, with Mark Griffiths having defaulted because of that injury. And in a two-man first heat, Jason Young beat Christian Clay. And this all left the leaders wondering if they had to complete the course at all, especially Bill Piddock.
I think I've got to. If Rob L wins this event, I've got to complete the course. I won't know that because it's an air heat, so I won't know. So I'm just going to go through the motions. Just hurt my arm, holds up. It's just a bit of bruise.
Oh my goodness.
Just, they say no pain, no gain.
Now you're leading this heat at the moment, yeah. So Lee, how about it for you?
Well, I can't really say a lot, really, because I mean, I know for definite that I'm already through to the final. So I'll just take things as they come.
Thank you, man.
Well, Bill Piddock right in the middle. The doctors have been hard at work on his arm. Robert Howe on the right-hand side, and then Lee Bowers on the far side. 200 kilograms this weight. And difficult enough to lift up, let alone walk with it. But at the moment, Bill Piddock is making it look easy. Robert Howe just ahead of Lee Bowers. Two flips of the tyre required, and this tyre weighing well over 800 pounds. That's Robert Howe. What a gutsy performer he's been. A great performance by Bill Piddock. He's miles ahead of the rest. The first barrel goes up easily. Lee Bowers on the far side, locked together with Robert Howe. And I think Northamptonshire, safe and sound, they're going to have a man in the final. Robert Howe is not going to make it, but he's still fighting. Here we go for Bill Piddock. Victory! Just over 48 seconds. Oh, watch out. Nearly in a collision there with Lee Bowers. He's showing very good form. Oh, what a shame for Robert Howe. He's really stuck on that tyre. Lee Bowers, well, he's not just going through the motions. He's going to complete this course. Come on, Robert, just one last effort. Absolutely no chance, he says to Jamie Reeves, so he's going to watch Lee Bowers instead. And Lee Bowers finishes in second place behind Bill Piddock. The two qualifiers for the final.
No, Lake Forest.
Plenty of power though from Piddock and Bowers, the big two, the only two to complete the course. And it shows just how far they were clear of the rest. 21 points each, and the rest nowhere. Piddock and Bowers through to the final.
Now, there was us thinking that you were going to take things easy.
I was, actually. I had to qualify, none of that.
And you said you did it when you came off with one hand.
I landed, I was. Should be a good final. A good final.
You two are just about the most experienced guys in Britain's Strongest Man this year. Is that going to make a difference?
Yeah, hopefully, it will do. Yeah. Should be a good tussle.
So six men now through to the final of the Energizer Battery Trophy. Bell, Mullins, Ross, Bryce, Pittock and Bowers.
So we know who six of the finalists are going to beat in this year's Britain's Strongest Man competition. One more heat to go. Let's hope it's as close as this race is going to be.
And that final heat is tomorrow at 7 here on BBC One. Next tonight, it's Pudsey's birthday and Gabby Roslin's celebrating.
At Alton Towers looking for Britain's Strongest Man who will walk away with the Energizer Battery Trophy. And this corkscrew is 750 metres long. Must have gone a hell of a bustle wide.
Six men already through to the final after three heats of bump and grind. Experienced competitors Lee Bowers and Bill Pittock carried all before them in the third heat. So Bell, Mullins, Ross, Bryce, Pittock and Bowers are through, just two more places to be filled. And here we are in heat four with a student, a health food shop owner, a managing director, an actor and a sawmill operator. Jamie Barr's 34, he's Scotland's strongest man. Steve Brooks, 33, back in the big time after recovering from a serious hand injury. Fraser Tranter, 33 as well, the tallest man in the competition. Seb Abatiello is 39 and he's a martial arts expert. And flying the flag for youth, 26-year-old Stephen Halliday. Once upon a time, Alton Towers was Europe's largest private house. And here in front of the castle, the first event of Heat 4. Only five men taking part here after Terry Perdue withdrew through injury. It's the farmer's walk, all about pressure on the forearms and biceps. The two cylinders weigh 500 pounds. Paul Dickinson commentating once more.
A lot of nerves in that tent this morning as the first competitor emerges. Sebastian Abatiello from Worcester. He said he was born to be big and strong, and he is that. 39 years old, the oldest man in this final heat. Steve Brooks from Spennymoor in County Durham, absolutely massive man, just look at those shoulders. Owns a health food shop, so knows all about health and fitness and obviously strength as well. Jamie Barr, physiology student from Scotland, comes from Glenrothes in Fife. Very athletic man is Jamie Barr. Fraser Tranter, the tallest man in this year's Britain's Strongest Man competition. Believe it or not, just a shade under 7 feet tall, the man from Wolverhampton. And finally, Stephen Halliday from Dumfries. Down to five competitors in this final heat, and a couple of the competitors out on the course already suffering from some injuries.
I was training and I fell and I've broken a bone in my wrist, so just have to wait and see what happens. I'm not training for a fortnight because of the injury, so I'm gambling everything on it's going to be all right.
Yeah, some events are a disadvantage, you know, with the ones that are, you just have to work a bit harder, but I've been looking forward to this event. You know, this is a good event for me as a role. Unfortunately, in practice yesterday, I did some damage to my arms, so I'm just getting my fingers crossed, you know, that it all goes well and that I get an ace card here.
Dougie Edmonds telling them to get ready. And so the final heat gets underway. Sebastian Abatiello on this side. Stephen Brooks is going well, along with Fraser Tranter in the red T-shirt. The turn is absolutely crucial. They've got to get balance, and Fraser Tranter has dropped his cylinders. That is Stephen Brooks' wife, Lynn. Oh, it's flying. He's over the line. That is phenomenal. Jamie Barr has come through into second place. The Scotsman will finish second, just ahead of Sebastian on this side. Great performance, though, by Stephen Brooks. He won it by miles. And Fraser Tranter, well, he's got to pick it up higher than anybody else, but he did say he was looking forward to this contest. I wonder if his injury has got worse. Fraser Tranter finishes in last place.
I have to say, your wife was a bag of nerves.
Yeah, I was. But I'm okay now.
Does that give you extra confidence for the other events now?
Yeah. I'll be into the final.
Great start, well done.
Cheers.
You are shaking,
aren't
you?
I am, like a leaf. I wanted to be over the fence and in there. And
that was great for him, wasn't it?
Yeah, brilliant.
Now, he was nervous because I spoke to him before the event, but you're a bag of nerves, I think, aren't you?
I was standing down early on, my stomach was just going round and round and round like a washing machine. But then when he gets on there, it comes out, the event comes out, you know.
Fantastic start, wasn't it?
Now I'll go away and calm down for the next one.
Okay, well done. Jamie, how's the hand?
It's stinging, but it held out, so that's the main thing. I just took my time and made sure I got over the line. That's what mattered.
Now, was I imagining things, or did you actually blow a kiss to Steve Brooks when you went across the line?
I blew my kisses. Everybody just does a carry-on. It's good fun, so there's no bad feelings getting beat. You get beat, you get beat. That's it.
Well, despite his wife's concerns, Steve Brooks okay, Jamie Barr too, but boy, did Fraser Tranter find it tough.
Well, lifting logs is a pretty serious kind of business, you know. You can jerk them or push-press them, but you can't split them or dip them. This one in particular, it's 380 kilograms in weight. And in anybody's terms, that's a captain's kind of log.
And we find our captain's log by coming across the lake.
It really is a startling contraption. They have to lift as many times as possible. And the effective weight that's bearing down on their shoulders, well, it's about 17 and a half stones.
Fraser Tranter.
First man to go, Fraser Tranter. And a lot of work to do now because he only picked up 2 points in that first event, having felt confident about it. No ill effects from the injury. And let's remember that Glenn Ross in Heat 2 lifted this log a phenomenal 18 times. Well, referee Dougie Edmonds there saying that Fraser Tranter's first repetition didn't count. So a bit of wasted energy there for the Wolverhampton man. Almost 7 feet tall, so he's got to press it. A phenomenal distance. He's got incredibly long arms, and that makes things more difficult. Up to 7, 8. Well, running out of steam just a little bit, but he looks determined. Now, can he squeeze one more repetition out? Come on, Fraser. Gets it to arm's length, but referee Dougie Edmonds says no. He didn't lock his arms out. Oh, he'll be disappointed with that. 9 in total, and I wonder how his injury is.
I was back to the doctor. I've been having treatment all morning on it, nursing it along. We've still got a rip in the top of the bicep there. So it's just been a hoping game.
Stephen Halliday now, the Scot, trains with Stuart Murray, who appeared in a previous heat. Fraser Tranter's 9, the total to beat. He's a pretty strong customer, is Stephen Halliday.
Two, oldest in the score. Three,
won his first ever competition at Blair Athol in Scotland. He knows his way about these competitions, and I think he's done a bit of training on this log before. He's going well. Eight.
Nine.
A very tough customer indeed goes into the lead. Well done to Stephen Halliday. He's showing very good form. It's over 115 kilograms, the pressure on their arms and shoulders. And that is remarkable. It's not like a weightlifting competition where you've only got to lift it once and he gets 13. That is going to be a very tough score to beat. And this could be Stephen Halliday's best event so far.
I'm quite strong on the shoulder, I was quite confident. I was looking for a bolt in the cane. But when I got there, I felt straight strong. You know? So I was quite happy with that, like, definitely.
Sebastian, I think you were pretty pleased after that first event. So has that given you a bit of confidence for this awesome log?
Yeah, a bit, but I'm nervous as well. I mean, you do this to absolute failure. And, you know, you don't know what you're going to do till you're out there and you've got the weight on your shoulders and start pressing it and whatever. So I'm just going to do the best I can, keep my fingers crossed, and just keep on pushing.
Sebastian Abbatiello going through a bit of mental preparation. He's
ready.
A very experienced competitor. He's got tremendous arms as well. They measure well over 20 inches in circumference. We may well see Sebastian in a feature film soon called Gladiator. Made in Hollywood, but this guy made in Worcester. Up to 8 repetitions, he's chasing Stephen Halliday's lead of 13. The record for Britain's strongest man, 18 repetitions by Glenn Ross, the Northern Ireland competitor in Heat 2. Oh, come on, Sebastian. Another repetition, he's equal with Fraser Tranter at the moment. The crowd are roaring him on. He's going to finish equal with the giant from Wolverhampton, Fraser Tranter. Sebastian, a little bit dejected. Jamie Barr, straight onto the platform. Now, this guy might not have the gross strength of some of these competitors, but he's very, very fit. Studying physiology, he knows exactly what's required here. He'd love to make it through to the final. The referee telling Jamie just to take the starting position a little lower. He loves his tattoos as well, does Jamie Barr. Highly decorated, you might say. But all he's interested in here is getting this log as many times over his head as possible, and he's going well at the moment. Two men on 9 repetitions. He's equal to that. Now, can he go past Fraser Tranter and Sebastian? Yes, he can. Chasing Stephen Halliday's lead, but he can't do it. He's going to settle for second place at the moment, and there's only Steve Brooks to go, holding his wrist, which is heavily strapped.
It's not too bad now, I'm finished, but it was really hurting. I couldn't set the bar where it's normally meant to go, so I had to try and adjust my hand so it's sitting across my thumb. But I got what I needed to get. I needed 10, so I'm just looking for places. Tomorrow's my day.
Well, if anybody was built for this event, it's Steve Brooks. He's got an extraordinary physique, absolutely enormous shoulders. Well, referee Dougie Edmonds telling him to lower it. I'm not sure he counted that first repetition. Look at the size of his triceps. Goes up to 4. Oh, he's discounted another one as well. So 2 already have gone astray. And that doesn't help, but Steve Brooks now chasing the 9 repetitions of Tranter and Abbatiello. He's got it. And goes one ahead. And discounted another one. Well, that's 3 so far. Oh, he's discounted yet another. This is incredible. This is a big disadvantage for Steve Brooks. He doesn't know what's going on in terms of the referee. I think he's not lowering it enough in between each repetition. Can he get another one? No, he can't. He finishes on 11. It's second place. And that is a big surprise victory for Stephen Halliday. And Steve Brooks saying to Jamie Reeves, what went wrong?
There's a strict range of movements allowed. That's a push press to the lock position. And there must be a full range of movement from below the chin to the lock position. Some of Steve's lifts were from this area. And also, at some of his lifts, he dipped at the top. So, he couldn't get the lifts, it's not in the rules.
It felt good to me. Would have won that easy.
Well, you did have about five disqualified, so that certainly would have won.
Yeah. Can't understand it.
Disappointed, obviously.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I would have won that. Easy.
Is this going to make a difference to the way in which you approach the next two events?
No, it'll just make us more aggressive. Perform even better.
Steve Brooks unhappy, but still good enough for second place. But for Fraser Tranter, the end of the road is nigh.
The doctors have told me this morning to pull out both the biceps badly strained and some of the muscle fibres are torn. So I'm just competing at 50%, and I feel this calibre, it just doesn't fit. You know, you've got to be 100% fit.
So now just four left in, but it's tight at the top, with Brooks, Barr and Halliday separated by just 2 points.
Is this just part of the uniform, do you think, to have the tattoos, or would you have done it anyway?
I mean, I was 32 before I actually decided to go and get one. I just fancied the Celtic pictures design. It took me maybe 6 months going every fortnight for 2 to 3 hours to get it done. It's just a lot of Pictish and Celtic designs mixed in there, some tribal designs. I would say this is more like body art. It's one colour and it flows with the contours of your body, whereas a tattoo, to my mind, is more like a picture of Scooby-Doo. But it's not going any further down here, and it's not going any further up here.
This is the loading race, 5 drags and 5 lifts. You have to pick up this sandbag and stick it on the top up there. Then you put the barrel next door to it, a log next door to that, the anchor next door to that, and in the end you put a chain right where I'm standing at the moment, and then you're going to have a lie down.
This courtyard was originally a stable block, built to look like a castle, so that diners at Alton Towers could look across the lake and see another castle. They did that sort of thing in those days, you know.
Now, what are the tactics here? Do you go flat out all the way, or do you pace yourself?
Pace yourself, generally. Other being watching the heat go by, they look pretty light, so we'll see how it goes.
My plan is, it's going to be a berserker job. That's what I call it, everything or nothing. I'm just going to go as fast as I can, as hard as I can, and hope it just comes together. That's all I can do. It's going to be one of them things of a lifetime.
Well, I'm sure Sebastian is hoping for a good performance here. I just wonder how Jamie Barr's hand is holding out.
Yeah!
Seb, full of energy. Yeah. He's a black belt in martial arts. Ready? He's a pretty tough customer. Well, this sack shouldn't be a problem. This weighs 60 kilos. It's quite awkward. And Jamie Barr throws it up there, as does Sebastian. The barrel, 75 kilos. And about 14 stones, and it is quite awkward to make it stay up there. Jamie Barr is away. And this is a real thinking event. You've got to figure out how to get it up there quickly and efficiently. So important. No doubt about Jamie Barr's strength or fitness. He's going very well indeed. The anchor, so awkward, weighs 100 kilos, nearly 16 stones. And Sebastian falling behind all the time. I don't think his dream is going to come true. Now this chain is the most awkward of the lot. 190 kilos, 30 stones in weight. And Sebastian having real problems with the anchor.
The whole chain has got to be on that lower part of the wall, and Jamie Barr has done it, just over a minute. Now, come on, Sebastian. He's a real showman. That weighs about as much as a car engine. But with the five links of the chain, it's so awkward to get up. Oh. Time is running out for Sebastian. 39 years old, the oldest man in this heat. Jamie Reeve there just stopping him falling off and giving him a lot of encouragement as well. Come on now, one big lift to go and he's got it. 1 minute, 44 seconds. Total and utter exhaustion.
I'm a wee bit quicker than the others because my body weight's lighter. But you never know what happens. I give it my best shot, so you can only just wait and see what the other two's going to come up with.
Steve Brooks is in pretty good shape, though, isn't he?
He is. He's improved greatly on his fitness as well, so... But I just hope I'm quicker. Jane Fonda classes have paid off.
Well, I'm not sure about Jane Fonda aerobics for these two. It's all about strength now. And guts and determination. Halliday on the left, Brooks on the right.
Ready?
Crashing down like sprinters. Away we go. The race is on. Brooks away quickly. Halliday, oh, just leaving that sack dangling over the wall, but it stays on. And Jamie Barr was afraid of Steve Brooks. Halliday is up in the points as well.
Three more.
If one of these objects falls off, well, they've got to put it back, but that's safe up there for Steve Brooks. Halliday about 5 seconds behind. Steve Brooks finding this anchor a little bit awkward. He's a shade slower than Jamie Barr with the anchor. Come on, Stephen, they're shouting. Now then, if he can get it up quickly, Steve Brooks could take the lead. Halliday fighting to get that anchor on the wall. Just 6 seconds left for Steve Brooks. Can he do it? No, Jamie Barr is still in the lead. Steve Brooks, well, it's so, so close. Jamie Reeve insisting the whole chain is on the platform. Oh, I think Steve Brooks may have hurt his hand a little bit. There's blood all over his finger. The doctor there straight away. And Halliday, I think he's had enough. Way outside the points on this occasion, and Brooks is being led away by the doctor for immediate treatment.
It was very tough. It was harder than I expected, yeah. I just blew up at the last, the chain. I nipped my finger, drew some blood, but still there.
Now, you're going to have some stitches in your finger. Is that going to affect the final event at all?
I hope not, but we'll have to wait and see. I shouldn't think so.
You're not the sort of guy that would count his chickens, but I think you probably realise now you are going to make it to the final, don't you?
Yeah, yeah. I said all along I'll get the final. And hopefully, well, I will be there.
This loading event looks as though it could have made a difference to the overall situation in terms of you going through to the final, even though there is one event to go.
Yeah. Well, tomorrow will have to win, I think, the event to be in the final. I thought it was going to be a good event for me today, but just in a way.
Is it the endurance or is it the awkwardness of the things you've got to lift or what?
It's pure fitness and anything else. A bit of strength and more fitness.
It's pretty hard though when you're about 20 stones in weight, isn't it?
Ah, it's definitely. It's trying to keep the fitness and the strength at the same time. It was really hard. I found that really hard to do.
Last event coming up.
It's off to go for it. What to be in the final. Definitely.
Well, a good result for Scotland's strongest man, Jamie Barr, winning that event ahead of Steve Brooks. Halliday back in fourth place. But there are still three of them in it, but for Stephen Halliday to make it through, Jamie Barr has to come fourth in this last event.
And so to the final event, the medley, carrying beer barrels, flipping tyres, and lifting this massive dead weight down the course. I tell you, it's not often you can say you've got 440 pounds between your legs.
In the intervening period, Steve Brooks had been to hospital to have those stitches because he knew he only had to start this event and pick up a single point to get through to the final, and that's just what he did. But even though this race became academic, Jamie Barr was still up for it.
Now, Jamie, rather like the last event, this event should suit you because you are a very fit man as well as being strong.
Yeah, it does. Plus, I've done the tie before, so I know what's coming. So I'll just get it on and get it over with, and that's it, done.
Well, Steve Brooks picking up that single point had now made it impossible for Halliday to overtake Barr. So this medley race became a matter of pride.
Sebastian on this side. He certainly wants to finish off with a flourish.
Yeah!
Jamie Barr. Tough Scotsman, with Yuka Ahola standing behind him, world's strongest man 2 years ago, here to help with his experience. Stephen Halliday, he's put on a tremendous show. And this guy, well, talk about show, he loves it. And the audience love him.
Yeah, come on.
Thank you, man.
So Jamie Barr, certain of a place in the final.
With your grip on the whistle.
Here we go. Sebastian away well, handling this 200 kilogram weight with ease, as is Jamie Barr, who sprints into the lead. Now this huge earth-moving tyre. They've got to flip it twice. Stephen Halliday from Dumfries, right in the middle. Jamie Barr, a fellow Scot, and it's Scotland in first place by a mile at the moment. The first of three barrels. Easy for Jamie Barr, and this is one tough customer who, together with Steve Brooks, should acquit themselves well in the final. Sebastian coming through, and at the moment Stephen Halliday in third place in this final event, and Jamie Barr has done it and has made it look so easy. Sebastian, come on now, one to go after this one. Well, it's all gone down to a stroll now. The four events they've all taken part in, a mixture of power, sheer strength, and endurance as well. And right now, their hearts will be beating to their absolute maximum. Abatiello not giving up. Will Sebastian be back bigger and stronger next year? I suspect he will. Halliday too. Stephen Halliday exhausted, Sebastian as well, but he's got plenty of support. Well done, my man. Now, you came into this competition with an injury. Did you really think you'd make it through to the final?
No, not really. I thought, you never know what's going to happen, but I didn't think I was going to get the final, but I have, so I just get on with it. But this will throb for a couple of days, some more painkillers, and it'll be all right.
Well, you've proved your fitness. The technicalities of the events are not a problem, no. So it looks pretty good for the final for you as well, doesn't it?
It's a lot heavier, eh? So I tend to lose because I'm taller and I'm lighter. I'm fine for running about, but when it comes to the static, I tend to lose a bit, especially in the pressing events. But it's never over till it's over, is it?
Jamie Barr exceeding his own expectations, but another event victory for him there, and Seb Abatiello getting his best result. So Barr and Brooks through to the final, but both carrying injuries. How is that going to affect them when it gets to the crunch? And there's the lineup for the final. Barr and Brooks joining Bell, Mullins, Ross, Bryce, Pittock and Bowers.
But as tough guys, strong guys go, they don't come much tougher or stronger than Jamie, who won that heat. Well done to you. But there's one final test you've got to perform here. Just show us how strong you really are. Well, the mid-60s is all these tough boys are managing to do on this machine, you know. But Leela's here. She's at school. She's 9 years old. And she'll show them how it really ought to be done. Go on, Leela. Beaten by a 9-year-old. Is that humiliating for Jamie or what?
Catch the final of Britain's Strongest Man on Saturday, 8:10, BBC One. Next up, EastEnders, and it's all happening at the Queen Vic.
the view from one of the towers that is Alton Towers, once a stately home in Victorian times, but now Britain's biggest theme park, and where today one man will take home the Energizer Battery Trophy and be crowned Britain's strongest man.
As the world's ultimate ride experience, Nemesis, the goddess of retribution. And for the 8 finalists, today is the moment of truth.
Format of the Energizer Battery Trophy, 8 contestants, 7 events. First up, Brian Bell, 32 years old, a bus driver. Graham Mullins is 33, he's a lorry driver. Glenn Ross, 28, and a chef. Colin Bryce is 24 and a TV researcher. Bill Pittock, 36 years old, a brewer. Lee Bowers, 31, and a meat porter. Jamie Bars, 34, a student at university in Scotland. And Steve Brooks is 33. He runs his own health food shop. It's going to be hot work today. Glorious blue skies, a warm sun, and the final of Britain's Strongest Man begins in front of the castle. Well, this first event is the only one in which all 8 finalists compete against each other. It's a game of 3 halves. The first section, you have to run and pick up this beer barrel that weighs a mere 105 kilograms and carry it down the course and stick it on a sledge at the end, and then you run back and make no mistake, some of these guys can run and pick up the sandbag that weighs 95 kilograms and bring that up here and stick that on the sledge as well. The sledge weighs 30 kilograms in its own right. That's a combined total of 230 kilograms overall, 37 and a half stone to you and me, and you drag the whole lot back to the end of the course, and the first one home wins.
And commentary comes from Paul Dickinson.
Tremendous nervousness out there on the course.
Mullins, Maltby, South Yorks.
The big Yorkshireman, Mullins.
Stephen Brooks.
Then Stephen Brooks from County Durham. An enormous
Colin
man.
Bryce, Glasgow.
Colin Bryce, a Scot now working in London.
Bill Pittock, Northampton.
He's one of the most experienced men here.
Jamie Barr, White.
And Scotland. Jamie Barr, who won the final heat.
Lee Bowers. Airby,
Lee Bowers has competed in World's Strongest
Brian
Man
Bell,
before.
Dundee.
And so has Brian Bell. And the biggest
Glenn
man
Ross,
of all, Glenn Ross from County Down. And just before the event started, Gary Richardson caught up with one or two competitors.
Looking at the barrels, it's a home for home from you, because you carry them around at work all
day,
don't you?
Yeah, a bit of an advantage, yeah, because I pick them up every day, so...
Yeah, you don't ever drink what's in them when you're at work?
No, I can't stand that.
No, because you work for a lager company, we won't say which one.
No, I won't say no. Probably the best.
In the world. who's going to be your main rivals today?
I think the lighter lads, Colin Bryce, Jamie Barr. But might be surprised, Glenn Ross is fairly quick for a big man, so I wouldn't like to say, really.
Yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I think it's my kind of event.
I've got a chance to gain some points here. You know, any event that's faster and, let's say, lighter than the static, slow events, I've got a chance.
You're a quick man then, are you?
Quicker. Yeah.
Well, I'm not sure there's a big sprinter out there, but we'll wait and see. It's certainly a lot to do with fitness. Away we go. The first event in the 1999 final of Britain's Strongest Man, and Bill Piddock is absolutely flying. Colin Bryce is there too. So is Lee Bowers. Back they go for the sack. Brian Bell going as fast as he can. Steve Brooks just picking up the sack. Bill Piddock is being caught by Colin Bryce. Well, Bryce on the right-hand side in the blue vest, a surprise finalist. There's Jamie Barr in the red. It's Piddock who's away first. Bryce having difficulty getting that sled moving. Glenn Ross just beginning his pull. Lee Bowers catching a little bit. Ross, who won his heat, is way behind. I think Jamie Barr's going to take it. What has Barr got left over the last meter? Jamie Barr just wins it. Bill Piddock about to finish in second place. Well done to him. Lee Bowers finishes now just ahead of Graham Mullins. Now, who's going to get the small points at the end? Oh, Glenn Ross pulling it while he's still on the ground. Then Brian Bell. It's been a very tough one. Colin Bryce, the last man out on the course. The lightest man in this final. So I guess he was always going to find this one tough. Just a single point for Colin Bryce. Oh, what about Steve Brooks? 5 points for him. Glenn Ross exhausted.
Well, I knew Bill. I'd watched him do it in the heats. I knew he was quick and he went away, miles away, but the thing that they failed in the heats on was the sledge. So my idea, paced myself with a sack in the barrel and then bust my ass doing the sledge, and it paid off. So I should have paced myself a little bit on the first run. I fired off a bit too quick, I think, and he let me down and dragged back. I lost a bit of power there, but second's good. I said Jeremy Barr, didn't I? I wish I'd have said that then. Today's a good day for me. Tomorrow I'll not get many points, so I've got to get as many as I can a day.
A flying start for Jamie Barr, but as he said there, he knows this is a marathon, not a sprint. Now let's face it, it wouldn't be a strongman event without some trucks. We've got two.
Some people say a man is made out of mud, a poor man's made out of muscle and blood and skin and bone, a mind that's weak and a back that's strong. You pull 16 tons and what do you get? Next event.
The course here is 30 metres long and this is real pressure on arms and legs.
Colin Bryce, the first to go, getting strapped in at the head of that truck and disappointed, I think, with his performance in the carry and drag.
I should have tried the equipment beforehand. It was a shock. I thought I'd just gently ease into it and start pulling it and then accelerate. I just couldn't pull it at all, so, yeah.
Of course, it didn't have wheels on. The things you're about to pull have got wheels on, but between them, they weigh 16 tons.
Don't remind me, I've never done this before, so I'll try my best.
Well, if he thinks the carry and drag was a shock, just wait until he starts to pull this.
Are you ready?
Yep. Technique is involved as well. They've got to stay low. Grip on the ground is so important. I think Colin is actually wearing some special climbing boots, and that should help just a little. I promise you, everything is going to hurt at the end of this event. The arms from pulling the rope. As John Inverdell was saying, the legs as well. And the heart and lungs will be working overtime. Coming up towards 30 seconds. This is a real gutsy effort by Colin Bryce. He's not the heaviest of men, but he's very, very powerful. He does a lot of running in his training, which is actually unusual for a guy this size. The truck goes past 25 meters. Being roared on by the crowd, being encouraged by Jamie Reeve, standing on the right-hand side there, a former World's Strongest Man. The truck has got to reach the line. It's so close now, and he gets it. Just under a minute for Colin Bryce. Oh, well, certainly a disadvantage to go first. That is what everybody else will be aiming for.
You just keep your legs pumping.
Keep breathing deep. Oh, that was inches away from not making it there.
Under a minute, though, 58 seconds.
Really? Oh, a bit of hope, maybe.
And tell us, when you started, did you feel, my goodness, there's loads of people watching, I'm not going to get going at all, and the trucks are going to stay right where they are? Did that ever go through your head?
My worst nightmare. I didn't sleep last night. I just saw myself pulling and pulling for a minute and a half, like an idiot, but oh well.
You set the standard.
Thank you.
Brian Bell now, one of the most experienced men in this final. 20 stones of solid muscle.
Are you ready? Yes. Get the strain.
He's got the climbing boots on as well. And this fella once broke a world record for the bench press exercise, nearly 600 pounds. Those massive arms are so, so strong. He's got his knees strapped as well. That will help. And Brian Bell is actually making tremendous progress. He came seventh in the first event, and that carried just 2 points, so he needs a good performance here. Oh, it's phenomenal by Brian Bell. 25 metres, just 5 to go. He's so far ahead of Colin Bryce, that's for sure. It's going to be a very quick time. Absolutely fantastic. 43.47 seconds for Brian Bell. Fantastic for the Scot.
Brian Bell's time was 43.47 seconds.
How do you react to that then?
It was very difficult, but I enjoyed truck pulling. It's better than carrying drag.
Are you surprised at the time?
I've never actually pulled two trucks, so I'm quite surprised, yeah.
And you've set the start standard, haven't you? 43 seconds.
Yeah, I've given all the rest a time to chase now.
Will they get close to it, do you think?
Well, I hope not, but you never know.
Well, Glenn Ross got close, but not close enough. His time, 45.35 seconds. And Graham Mullins really found it tough going. 51.22 was his time.
Take the rope!
Steve Brooks now, the man with muscles bulging everywhere. The pride and joy of Spennymoor in County Durham. He loves this event as well. He really does fancy his chances. But what a performance by Brian Bell. 43.47 seconds. Well, Steve Brooks off to a very good start here. Sails past 5 metres and past 10 metres. His wife Lynn will be in the crowd feeling as nervous as ever, and Steve Brooks is accelerating. He's getting faster. Taking short steps is so important. He's got the technique absolutely perfect on this occasion. He really is chasing Brian Bell's time. He's giving it everything, slowing down just a shade here. It's going to be so, so close. Oh, he's just outside, 44 seconds, but he goes into second place. A tremendous start for Steve Brooks in his first ever Britain's Strongest Man final.
But Brian Bell's time was still taking all the beating. Lee Bowers could manage 48.03. And then Jamie Barr clocked a time of 47.16. So that left just one man try and win the truck pull.
Are you ready, Bill?
Well, the rest of the competitors will be sweating just a little bit, especially Brian Bell and Steve Brooks, as Bill Piddock gets away. Now, Bill Piddock has competed in this event at World's Strongest Man level before. He's not taking short, fast steps like we saw from Steve Brooks, slightly longer, and probably using the arms to great effect as well. This man who won his heat, beating Lee Bowers into second place and coming back from a long period of injury, desperately would love to win this title. The target, 43.47 seconds, is going to be very, very close. Oh, Brian Bell has won it, and I think Steve Brooks is safe in second place. That is a good start, though, by Bill Piddock. Third place for sure. Oh, staggers to his feet, but a great performer.
Bill Pittock's time was 45.12 seconds.
So everybody completed the course, but Brian Bell's time proved unbeatable. Half a second clear of the rest.
43, 47, the time was good enough.
Yeah, it was good enough from the start. Like, it's always difficult going first because everyone's got your time to go for. But I knew I could be close to winning it. Like, that's the first time I've actually pulled two trucks together, so I'm quite pleased to come out on top on that one.
Well, this looks like it could be a really close competition. 5 points separating the top six after two events. So here we are in the courtyard of Alton Towers for another old favourite of strongman events. Let's face it, if you're not pulling trucks, you're lifting stones. And this involves five stones weighing between 95 and 135 kilograms being lifted onto their designated spots on top of a wall.
In blue,
Graham Mullins on the right-hand side and Colin Bryce on the left. Well, so far, Colin Bryce has found life a little bit difficult in his first ever Britain's Strongest Man final. Graham Mullins, much, much bigger than Colin. There's a huge difference in their physiques.
On the whistle.
Five stones to go. I'm not sure either of these two guys has ever lifted all five. Tremendous start by Colin Bryce. Old Graham Mullins in all sorts of problems. That first part of the wall is over 6 feet. And Colin Bryce has got the technique off to a fine art. Already one stone ahead of Graham Mullins. Mullins, the gritty Yorkshireman. Bryce, the Scot. That one's safely up for Mullins. Well, Colin Bryce is going very well indeed here. And the timekeepers will be taking the time that each stone is successfully placed on top of the wall in case there is a tie. Oh, that's his first mistake. He's all over the place. Graham Mullins just having a little glance across there. They're now equal on stones, but Bryce ahead on time. This could go down as Bryce's best performance so far in the final. There's a long way to go, though. And this is where exhaustion really takes its toll, but that was a tremendous performance by Graham Mullins. He now moves ahead of Colin Bryce. Jamie Reeves, the judge on this side, knows this man very well indeed, and certainly he'll be giving him just a few tips. Can he get five on board? This is Colin Bryce, fourth. I think they've just about had enough. So, first blood goes to Graham Mullins. Frustration for Colin Bryce.
4 in 68 seconds. How good is that?
That's pathetic. I did 4 in about 50 seconds in the heat. But it's been a very long day. I don't think there's an ounce of strength left in my legs. My back, I think my back's at home somewhere. I don't know where my back is. And energy levels are probably zero. It's just pure willpower and determination that drove it on. But I wanted that first time.
Lee Bowers of Erie.
Lee Bowers from Lancashire. And he's done this event before too, as has Jamie Barr. I suspect out of the two of them, Jamie Barr the most experienced. Jamie Barr, one of the joint leaders with Steve Brooks overall. It's a beautiful day here at Alton Towers. Tremendous crowds too. Oh, almost together. Easy does it. Only Bowers just crunching himself against the wall with that first stone, but gets it up successfully. Jamie Barr, 12 points in total from the first two events. Lee Bowers just rolls that up his chest. And that second stone there weighs about 16 and a half stones. Well, we've yet to see a man get all five up in this final. Colin Bryce got 3 stones up in 27 and a half seconds. I think Jamie Barr has moved ahead of that target easily. The next target is 4 by Graham Mullins. Jamie Barr is deceptively strong. He actually weighs about 19 and a half stones, but he doesn't look it. And that is 4. faster than Graham Mullins, so he moves into the lead. Lee Bowers struggling just a wee bit. It's Lancashire up against Scotland at the moment. Lee Bowers from Colne in Lancashire, 20 stones and 6 feet tall. He can't wrap his arms around that ball. Now come on, Jamie, one more to go. A massive effort and he could do it. Barr on the far side has actually got his arms heavily strapped because this thing really does scrape the arm, something terrible. Jamie Barr takes the lead in this third event. Just confirming his time and performance.
Jamie, you were so close to getting all five up, but you didn't quite make it in the end.
Just run out of steam, eh? Just tired. That's three hard events we've had today. Main thing is I beat Mullins. Sassenach.
Two awesome figures up next. Glenn Ross from Northern Ireland. 10 stones heavier than Bill Pittock. It seems almost unbelievable.
Ready!
Now, what sort of endurance have they both got? Certainly, Glenn Ross showed us in his heat that although he's a big man, he can move pretty well. Bill Pittock, as we already know, having seen him in this first event, is a real sprinter. And it's Pittock who moves ahead first. A lot of the competitors put tacky, some very sticky stuff indeed, on their forearms to help with the grip, and it seems to be helping these two. It's Jamie Barr in the lead at the moment. Nobody has lifted all five, though. And look at this, Glenn Ross is moving ahead of Bill Pittock. Tremendous performance by Glenn Ross. Pittock gets three up as well. And Glenn Ross is moving like a train now, just one to go, and he could win it with this one. Bill Pittock just struggling just a little bit, and he's done it! Just making sure it stayed on top of the wall. Oh, yes. Well, Bill Pittock has still got a lot of work to do. Trying to get on level terms with Jamie Barr and Brian Bell. Can't do it. Graham Mullins got four up as well, so a bad performance there for Bill Pittock, but brilliant by Glenn Ross.
That was easy, wasn't it?
Oh, the stones are never easy. Never easy. I'm just pleased. I mean, look who I'm up against. They get all five up.
And you did all five in under a minute.
Well, I've just been watching the biggest stone lift in the world, Lazo Fakaday. He's a wee bit of a belly too. He raises on his chest, flips him up with his gut. And I've been practicing that, so that's been working.
The final pair, Steve Brooks. Chasing an incredible lead, 55.90 seconds. The same for Brian Bell.
Ready.
I saw Brian Bell do an exhibition of this stone lifting in Scotland once upon a time, and he did five with ease. Steve Brooks there hoisting it onto his shoulder. It's almost a case of the tortoise and the hare in this event. There's no point in going off too quickly because you're definitely going to run out of steam by the time you get to the fifth stone. Steve Brooks is going well though, 2 stones ahead of Brian Bell. Jamie Barr at the moment is in second place, 4 stones in 54 and a bit seconds. Brian Bell's third, just on top. Oh, Steve Brooks struggling now. This one getting on towards 18 stones. And Steve Brooks has done it. Oh yes, come on, he says, more support. He might be wasting a little bit of time doing that though. Perhaps Glenn Ross heading towards his first victory in this final. Steve Brooks running out of time. And he's got it. He's going to get second place. Glenn Ross has won by over 14 seconds. And what can Brian Bell do? He can't quite make the fifth stone, and I think his time for four is slower than Jamie Barr. It certainly is by a couple of seconds, so Bell down in fourth place.
Well, that really was a fantastic performance for a man with a bad back.
Yeah, I just blocked it out. I was in two minds to do it or not.
in the tent.
Second fastest time of the day as well.
Second fastest. Yeah, it felt good. Hopefully, I'll stay in first position tomorrow. Another two good events for Sunday. Just have to dig in, keep it there.
Only Ross and Brooks managed all five stones, but Ireland's strongest man in a class of his own, 14 seconds clear of the rest. Brooks scoring consistently at the top, Ross up from sixth to third, and with the exception of Colin Bryce, it's anybody's race.
Well, these guys have got thighs like tree trunks, and now they've got to lift one. Some small acorn sometime produced this mighty oak that weighs 60 stone, and they've got 90 seconds to lift it from their chest, over their head, locking out the arms as often as they can. Log on with Britain's strongest man.
All the competitors I talk to, nobody seems to like this event.
They're all lying. It's only me that's not any good at this. Me and Colin will be fighting for last place here, because we both did 10 in the heats, so we'll just have to wait and see. It's like everything else. Everybody says this or that, but next thing, the proof of the pudding's when you actually do it.
Talking to one of the competitors, he said, anybody that does 17, they'll probably win it.
Yeah, I would agree with that. I'd reckon Glenn would be the winner here for this event. Suits him, static. Static events suit Glenn.
Hopefully it should be my day this today, you know. Par events in my game, like. Sort of relying on these par events to get my points up in this competition to give me a chance of winning it, like.
Bill Piddock, Northampton.
Go on, Bill. Bill Piddock, a gritty competitor, and he's going to need all his experience and determination in this one. The weight that he's bearing down on the shoulders is about 17 and a half stones.
Luke. One, wait for the count.
Oh, he's been told by Dougie Edmonds just to wait, but that three, one was counted. He's up to three already.
Four. Five.
He's not wasting any time at all. And this is good technique.
Seven.
Little push from the knees as well. That always helps.
Nine.
And John Inverdale was saying that most of these guys have got thighs like tree trunks. They've got arms about as big as my thighs. They're huge guys. And this is a very good performance indeed. Is he going to get 15? Yes, he does. Squeeze one more out. Not quite, but that is a tremendous performance by Bill Piddock. Very disappointed in the last event. He set a very tough standard for everybody else. I've only seen this event a couple of times before, but that's one of the biggest totals I've seen, that's for sure.
I've never done it before. It's a bit strange. Very strict, you know, you have to hold it for a count and put it down, but I'm pleased with that 15. That set the lads a record to go for.
Is it going to be enough to do it?
I doubt it, there's some big presses in there. But I'm pleased with that. That should put me up there.
Well, Lee Bowers is one of the big pressers. And being told by Jamie Reeves exactly what is required as far as the technique is concerned. All these competitors under the watchful eye of Dougie Edmonds, and he stands no nonsense, I can promise you that. The log has to go to arm's length, and then it must come down just below the chin. Oh, it looks so easy. That's 110 kilos. Five times so far for Lee Bowers. He's about 6 feet tall. And 20 stones in body weight.
Nine.
And is making this log look so easy.
Ten.
Chasing the lead of Bill Piddock at 15. Glenn Ross it was, who lifted it 18 times in the heats. We've yet to see him.
14.
One more brings him level with Piddock.
15.
And he's still looking good. He's still got plenty of puff left as well. He's in the lead.
17.
Oh, tremendous by Lee Bowers. 18. That equals Glenn Ross's phenomenal performance. Now, come on, one more. Oh, tremendous by Lee Bowers. Just ran out of steam in the end. Oh, yes. That is going to be tough for everybody else to beat.
Well, we were impressed with 15, but you've done 18.
Yeah, I wish I could have done a few more, but I have to do something after yesterday's disaster.
It looked fairly easy for you,
yeah.
Surely not.
Yeah, I'm the king of the presses.
I don't care what Glenn says.
Well, Colin Bryce certainly isn't king of the presses. Just 11 for him. Graham Mullins managed 13, but struggling for a big man. And Brian Bell, after that good start, could only manage 14 here.
Jamie Barr said he wasn't looking forward to this event, had all sorts of problems with his wrist in the heats. That seems to have cleared up. But there will be an enormous amount of pressure on his hands, his wrists and his elbows in this event. Jamie Barr lying in second place overall behind Steve Brooks.
One. Two.
It's been a tremendous standard in this competition so far. Lee Bowers, of course, in the lead with 18. Bill Piddock with 15.
Five.
Then Brian Bell with 14.
Six.
And Jamie Barr is a very thoughtful character. Likes to figure out the tactics and the technique before every event takes place.
Nine.
He's struggling just a little bit.
Ten.
One more will bring him level with Colin Bryce. Now, can he do it? Oh, that's enough. He wasn't expecting a great deal from this event. Still got time to have a laugh with Jamie Reeves, though. In last place at the moment.
You weren't looking forward to it.
And you can see why, yeah? I would tell you what it was, but I'm not allowed to swear on the telly.
Worse than you thought it was going to be?
No, just exactly what I thought it was going to be. Crap.
Last minute instructions from Jamie to Steve Brooks. The wind's blowing quite a lot here at Alton Towers today, but it's still pretty hot and the competition is intense. Now, Steve Brooks had terrible problems in the heat. He wasn't lowering it far enough. And he wasn't locking his arms out, but there's no mistake now. The referee disallowed about five lifts in the heat, but so far, so good. And we've been told by the referee that the greatest number of lifts ever in this event is 18, and that's something that Glenn Ross achieved in the heat, and Lee Bowers has already done today. Big Edmund saying, take it lower. But Steve Brooks is all right, 14. Grinning his teeth, he's just missed one there. 16, that's a tremendous performance. And he's got 17, by far and away his best performance. And he's in second place behind Lee Bowers. Well, he was all over the place in the heat. That was much better.
If I stay fit and healthy, I'll make it.
And Glenn Ross is about to come on,
yeah.
And he fancies this, doesn't
he?
Yeah,
Glenn's a good press, no doubt about it. But Glenn's a few points behind me. There's a lot of run events tomorrow, which I'm quick.
Glenn Ross!
The final competitor, Glenn Ross, already the king of the Atlas Stones. Can he become king of the giant log lift? He's already seen Lee Bowers equal his performance in the heats of 18 repetitions.
Lower, please. Lower.
Ooh.
Lift.
Well,
one.
Wasted energy at the start there.
Two.
And unlike all the other competitors, Glenn's not three. Bothering to use his legs. So strong are his
four.
Arms.
Come on, Glenn.
Those five. Biceps and triceps measure about 24
six.
Inches.
Come on,
oh, seven, that's bigger than some people's waists.
Eight.
Come on, Glenn.
Heading towards 10.
10.
It will be a world record if he can beat 18.
12.
And that would be superb points for Glenn Ross.
14.
Equal with Brian Bell on 14.
15.
Now Bill Piddock on 15.
16.
Chasing Steve Brooks, 17 now.
17.
And he gets it.
18.
Can he do one more? Is he going to allow that
18.
One? No, he's not. That means that Lee Bowers and he are absolutely dead level pegging at the moment. Come on, Glenn, one more, and he's got it. A new world record, maximum points for Glenn Ross. And Big Daddy he is. Two events in a row.
Well, at 18, it looked like you were stuck, but you made it to 19.
Well, just take a deep breath.
close my eyes. And the man above gave me another one.
So a second win for Ross, ahead of Lee Bowers, who must have thought that was going to be his event. A bad result for Jamie Barr, not unexpectedly so. And Brooks and Ross are now pulling clear of the field, but there are still three events to go. Jamie Barr, though, slipping down the charts.
Well, after four events, these guys are really motoring now, but how much have they got left in the tank? This is another real brute strength event. We're talking upwards of 50 stone here. The guys had to pick up these cars and hold them off the ground for as long as is humanly possible, until they break.
You don't care for this next event, do you?
No, not really. It hasn't been very helpful to us in the past. Plus I've got an extra hindrance in my lower back. Like I've been doing all competition, I'll just hang in there.
You say you got this back injury, but nevertheless, you're still leading, aren't you?
Yeah, I don't know how.
Steve Brooks was telling us he doesn't like this one, and yet he's leading, so maybe this could be where he'll slip up.
I said I had a sore back as well, eh?
He said I had a sore back, I did fall down, so
I think he's telling puppies.
We don't believe him no more.
No, he's lying to us. We're going to get him
out. He's sulking us out.
Well, there's a lot of kidology goes on in this event, but they're all great mates, really. Colin Bryce on the left-hand side in blue, and Jamie Barr on the right. The lifting strap's so important to maintain a good grip. Colin Bryce in last place at the moment with 7 points in total. Jamie Barr, third equal. I just wonder, with them standing back to back like that, if they'll be worried or bothered about what the other one is doing. Colin Bryce off to a shaky start. Jamie Barr looking pretty solid. Certainly a disadvantage going first, because then everybody else will know exactly what they've got to do. Oh, Colin's struggling a little bit. Heading towards 30 seconds. Jamie Barr still looking pretty steady. Come on, Colin, just a little bit more. Jamie Barr too. Don't bite your tongue off, for goodness sake. Oh, and Colin Bryce is down. Now, I'm sure Jamie Barr knows that. He would have heard the noise. So he wants precious more seconds. We saw a time of over a minute in the heat. If he can get anywhere near to that, it would be phenomenal. He's almost bent double. He's down in 54 seconds. That is a tremendous start by Jamie Barr and a gutsy performance by Colin Bryce. Well, the analysis of that event will go on for many hours yet, I'm sure.
54 seconds. How good a time is that?
Well, it's as good as I could do. You're just going to have to wait and see what the rest of them, but I needed the point, so I had to pull something out the bag. It's who wants it most. And I needed to make up for my last dismal display, shall we say. So one did one's best.
Graham Mullins this time on the right-hand side. Big man. Brian Bell, about 3 or 4 inches shorter than Mullins.
Graham, are you ready? Brian, are you ready?
Both men ready. Mullins lying in seventh place overall. Brian Bell equal third with Bill Pittock. Bell looking solid, Mullins looking solid. Graham Mullins did ever so well in the heats at this event, but shifting around the platform, he doesn't want to do that. He's asking for the time. He wants to be told exactly what the clock is saying. They know exactly what they've got to beat. It's Jamie Barr's 54 seconds they're aiming for. Both men standing at a slight angle. The grip on the feet has got to be pretty good as well. Mullins shouting at himself. Bell a little quieter, contemplating a possible lead here. Heading towards 50 seconds. This is a good performance by both men. They go past Jamie Barr, and they know it. The time is being shouted out. Oh, Bell goes down just under a minute. Graham Mullins is hanging on for dear life, and he's gone now too. 65 seconds plus for Mullins. Goes down on his knees. He's absolutely exhausted, as is Brian Bell, just being supported there. The doctor comes rushing onto the stage. Have a closer look at Graham Mullins. Oh, my goodness gracious me, it's really taken its toll, this event.
When you're back-to-back with somebody and you can feed off them and you're trying to outwit them in your particular run, it makes it a lot easier to stand out there on your own. But I think the crowd made a big difference as well.
And when they've dropped the car, that encourages you to go on?
It does, yeah, because I was struggling and it was hurting like hell. The back, the breathing, I dug it out to 20. I thought, what? But I hung in there and it feels good now.
Well, it might not feel good in the next minute or so for these guys. Bill Piddock on the left, Steve Brooks, the overall leader on the right-hand side. The straps are tight. The knee wraps just in the right place. It's a great lead by Graham Mullins at 65.13. These guys are chasing. Here we go. Steve Brooks a little later to rise than Bill Piddock here. Now, Piddock is a magnificent power lifter. Steve Brooks bulging with muscles. Both of them looking pretty steady at the moment. Steve Brooks just blowing a little bit. It's important to get oxygen into the lungs. As soon as oxygen debt sets in, that is the end. 30 seconds for both men. And believe me, this is a huge weight. The whole car weighs nearly a ton. So the weight that they're feeling through the hands, well, it's about 800 or 900 pounds or thereabouts. Oh, he's gone. What a surprise. Bill Piddock down there in 46.26 seconds. Steve Brooks still looking strong, now chasing for the lead. 10 seconds to go for him. If the clock goes past 65 seconds, he's going to beat Graham Mullins. And he's done it. That's a tremendous performance by Steve Brooks, the overall leader after four events, by 1 point from Glenn Ross, and who knows, he may be in the lead after this one too. Tremendous performance by Brooks, being helped off the stage by former World's Strongest Man, Yuka Ahola.
You actually have a car in your back garden that you go out and pick up from time to time, don't you?
Yeah, I've got a couple of cars, one I carry and one I can pick up from the back and stuff. Yeah, but it's something that I've got quite a good deadlift, and so I'll just work hard here today. Like I say, you're relying on the crowd cheering and stuff and the buzzing.
So here we go, Glenn Ross on the right-hand side. Lee Bowers, who's a tremendous power lifter, tremendous deadlifter. Should be technically very good at this event, the man on the left-hand side.
Lee, are you ready?
Yes.
Together, on the whistle.
So Lee Bowers, only lifting in his socks. He hasn't got any shoes on at all. In powerlifting, that is a recognised way of lifting these sort of weights. Apparently it helps with the position they're in. Oh, Glenn looks totally composed, doesn't he? Absolutely rock solid. Lee Bowers is the one who's moving just a little bit. Well, Steve Brooks' lead, 68.53. Glenn Ross just a point behind overall after the last event, so this is a very important one for him. Just two events to go after this one, and Lee Bowers shaking just a little bit. Perhaps it wasn't such a good idea after all not to put some footwear on. He looked as though he was slipping a little bit there. Ross is still as steady as a rock. Now heading towards a minute. Their first target is Brian Bell's 59.61. They've got it. Now to Graham Mullins, 65 seconds. It's going to be very close. Oh, they move ahead of Mullins. Ross is the first to go. And Lee Bowers has beaten Steve Brooks. Absolutely fantastic. A maximum 8 points for him, and Glenn Ross is in the points once more.
Lee, you made that look as though you were picking up a toy car.
I wouldn't say it was quite easy. That the lift isn't the difficult bit about it. It's just the holding on. It's the power, it saps your power.
Because early on when you were shouting for the times, I thought, hello, he's going to pack up after about 20 seconds, but you didn't.
Yeah, well, I just kept on this. Things at stake. Got to keep going.
He certainly did. At last, a deserved victory for Lee Bowers, who's now right back in contention. He beat Steve Brooks and Glenn Ross in that event, and it's becoming a three-horse race between them. Bowers, four behind Ross, six behind Brooks, who's still leading. So things hotting up now with two events to go and everything to play for. Down by the lake, another old favourite.
Well, this is the most traditional of all strongman events, the Húsafelt stone. Old Icelandic legend has it that if you could lift this odd triangular-shaped thing, you could marry the eldest daughter of the house. And it's called the Húsafelt stone because that's the noise you make when you drop it on your foot. It's 165 kilograms, that's 24 stone, give or take, and there's no time limit on this event, so if you want to take all day carrying it down the course, you're more than welcome to.
Okay.
Oh, a big sigh there from Colin Bryce, the first to attempt the Húsafell stone. And this is an event we traditionally see at Highland Games all over Scotland during the summer, so Colin knows it well. Gets the arms locked around the narrowest part of that huge rock, and also taken off a pedestal for the first time, rather than having to lift it off the ground. Well, he's going well. Actually, the bottom part of that rock appears to be tucked in his belt. There it is. I'm not sure he's allowed to do that, but he's getting away with it for the time being. And Jamie Reeves there, just telling him to make the first turn. 30 metres covered with ease. Well, maybe a little bit of gamesmanship on behalf of Colin Bryce. And incidentally, tradition also has it that the record distance covered by anybody with this giant stone was by an Icelandic woman. Colin Bryce heading down towards his starting position. That's 60 metres covered. Going well. And the bottom part of the stone tucked even further into his belt. My goodness. I wonder what the judges will say about that. Just short of 75 metres. Colin Bryce absolutely exhausted. And his arms are covered in bruises. Colin Bryce enjoying the experience and enjoying the fact that I think he's pulled a fast one over the judges. The rock is definitely tucked in the top of that belt. I wonder if anybody else has noticed that. Well, Bill Piddock must have been desperately disappointed with his seventh place in the last event.
Get ready.
The former England strongest man is in sixth place overall, 11 points down on the leader, Steve Brooks. Well, away we go. Offered a charge. Jamie Reeves in attendance. And despite the fact Jamie has given up competition, he's still a huge man himself. Very tight grip by Bill Piddock. He's got rubber protectors wrapped around his arms as well. That's pretty good thinking. Jukka Ahola put his arm up to say 30 metres covered. Chasing the lead by Colin Bryce. Two and a bit length, 74 metres plus. Now Bill Piddock is beginning to stagger just a little bit. Oh my goodness, it's like the Ministry of Silly Walks. But he makes the turn. Oh, I thought he was going to drop it. He's just hanging on by his fingertips now. He's going to go past 70. Near to 75. He's gone past Colin Bryce. Bill Piddock is in the lead. The last few metres must have been absolute agony. 78 metres, 22. He gave everything to that event and it's paid off.
For Jamie Barr, another tough event, 64.85 metres for him. For Brian Bell, even tougher, 43.6. And for Lee Bowers, a very disappointing result. He was in contention, but only 49 metres. And look at Graham Mullin's face. The pain he was in was simply unbearable. He twisted muscles at the base of his spine, and after 30 metres, he'd had more than enough. So just the two leaders to go. In a moment, Steve Brooks, but first, Glenn Ross.
Well, long arms, as we've seen, are very important.
Lift.
I wonder how Glenn Ross is going to get on here. He's certainly got something to rest that rock on, hasn't he? Seems to be going well. Looks pretty comfortable. And I guess one of the difficulties of this event is that you can't see where you're going. So Jamie Reeves going left a bit, right a bit, and at the moment, Glenn Ross is going all right a bit. Round the turn, 30 metres. And this, I think, is going to be a very important event for Glenn Ross. 2 points behind the overall leader, Steve Brooks, and just one event to go. If he can get an advantage here, he could be in with a big, big chance of winning Britain's Strongest Man this year. Now, can he make the turn once again and head off towards Jamie Barr's target of 64 metres in third place? No, he can't. The Northern Ireland man at the moment in fourth place, 59 metres 50.
The stone was heavy.
It was just pressing against your chest. I just couldn't breathe. You know, nothing there to breathe with. So I'm disappointed, really.
Steve Brooks. Nervous moments for him at the start. If he can win this event, he will go into the last event with a big advantage over the rest. Glenn Ross down in fourth place at the moment. The second place man. A good tight grip. All these men have got massive grips. They develop that through the huge amount of weightlifting they do. Steve Brooks looks a little unsteady on his feet at the moment, but heading towards 30 metres. Oh, he looks a bit unsteady. Easy does it. He's got a huge chest. But like all the others, I think having difficulty breathing. Now he's losing his grip. He's going off course. Oh, my goodness, he's gone. That's only 40 metres. He's absolutely flat out. And this could make a huge difference to the overall result. The doctor's on there very quickly with oxygen. I hope it's not too much of a problem for Steve Brooks.
It was terrible. Just couldn't breathe at all. I had a good hold of it. I just couldn't breathe. Simple as that.
The competition really is wide open, isn't it?
Yeah.
Your thoughts?
120% for last event now.
And out the blue from nowhere, a win for Bill Pittock and a great result for Colin Bryce in second place. Glenn Ross in fourth, Steve Brooks seventh.
It's not over yet, so a good event for me next, fitness event, I'll be there. Thanks to these two boys.
Samuel and Jason, what do they reckon?
They said I'll be number one today on Father's Day. They sent me a card with number one written on, so that was it. Dad done it, didn't he, boys?
Yeah.
Is Dad going to do it?
Yeah.
Yeah, who's the man?
Dad's the man.
Good luck.
Well, if he's going to win, the men ahead are going to have to falter, because realistically, it now looks as though it's head-to-head, Ross against Brooks. Well, the last event is the medley. Carrying a sandbag, flipping a tyre, pushing a truck, and just for fun, there's another 60 stone tyre in the back of it.
Sandbags are pretty straightforward. I'll be flicking them onto my shoulder, pacing myself. The tyre, haven't really done the tyre. I never did it in the heats. But I've learned and watched a lot. The truck is just a basic push.
It's a bit like the heat I had to go through, you know. I had to really turn it on for the heat. It was a fitness event, and I did, and I won my grip. So I'm just going to have to do the same here again, just grip my teeth and knuckle down and do the business.
I really need to guarantee a win here to guarantee me third place, so this is it's pride here that's at stake.
We've mentioned all the way through how sporting you all are towards one another. Do you wish them luck just before the start now?
Of course, dear. I hope the best man of the day wins, and I'll be the first to shake his hand. Hopefully with my own. It's not over yet. It's not over till the fat lady sings. Yeah, fat lady.
Well, the men in first and second place, Glenn Ross and Steve Brooks, go in the next heat. So now it's up to Colin Bryce, Brian Bell, Jamie Barr and Graham Mullins on the far side to really try and finish with a flourish. Graham Mullins cites his hero in this sport as Jeff Capes, a former Britain's Strongest Man and World's Strongest Man. They're away well. It's been a baptism of fire at this level of competition for Colin Bryce. Graham Mullins, last to appear over the line for the second sack. At the moment, it's Jamie Barr in the lead. As we've seen with previous events, Jamie Barr moves so well, but so does Colin Bryce. And now this awesome tyre. Mullins taking his time. Barr over just a whisker ahead of Colin Bryce. And you heard what Jamie Barr had to say. He wants to win this event overall to try and get up into the top three. And Barr it is now with the truck, head down, legs pumping. Bryce in second place. Jamie Barr is certainly going to win here. If he can set a fast time, he's got a real chance of moving into third place overall. He wins it. Bryce in second place. Brian Bell in third, Mullins a long, long way back. And Mullins, injured in the last event, is going to be so disappointed at the end here. The ecstasy of finishing, but the agony of the performance.
We've got to wait and see. It's Otley Bowers and
Bill Pettit does at Mars.
You could yet sneak in to second place, maybe.
Third will do me. I'll be happy with third.
And third place is the most realistic for Jamie. But the battle for the title is between Glenn Ross on the right-hand side and the man next to him, Steve Brooks. Brooks must finish at least two places ahead of Glenn Ross to beat him. Away we go. The end of what has been an enthralling contest, and Bill Piddock must beat Jamie Barr to stay ahead of him in the overall standings. There's the Northamptonshire man. Oh, he really does move well for a guy who's 20 stones in weight. And it's Steve Brooks who's moving ahead of Glenn Ross. That spells danger, because Lee Bowers is ahead of Ross as well. Now the tyre. What an exhausting way to finish the seventh event. 300 kilos plus, and so difficult to move. Well, Bill Piddock is still in the lead, but Glenn Ross is coming back. Glenn Ross is just marginally ahead of Steve Brooks, and that's so important to decide the title. Here comes Glenn Ross. If he can stay in this position, he will be Britain's strongest man. Bill Piddock is in fact slower than Jamie Barr, so Barr will finish in third place. And Glenn Ross wins the title. What a magnificent performance. Steve Brooks in second place. And Lee Bowers trailing home in last place in this final event. That won't do his position on the leaderboard any good at all. But there's only one man today can be crowned as champion, and his name is Glenn Ross.
Unbelievable. Unbelievable.
It was touching.
I did this for my son, Mark, who's born, not even a year old. And I did it for him.
It was touch and go for a timeout there, wasn't it?
Can't believe it. I just kept seeing his face. I'm so happy, you know.
Fifth place enough then for Glenn Ross, because his main rival Steve Brooks found it even tougher and came sixth. And Jamie Barr's victory was crucial because it pushed him up to third place. Ross 39, Brooks 37, Barr 36, Piddock 35. They were the top four.
That's my champion there.
Oh, he's just woke up, so yeah.
So what's it like then, now that you've done it all? Was it all worthwhile, all the hard work, the training?
Yeah, I give up my day work this year to really, really concentrate on strongman events. Trying to get a bit fitter, because I didn't have the mobility last year. I had the strength, but I wasn't mobile enough. I lost a wee bit of weight, I think, but I got 10 times more mobile.
Well, very, very well done.
Thanks.
Britain's strongest man. You don't need a hand to hold the baby.
No. No.
Well done.
Yes!
And so, after several days of grueling competition at Alton Towers, the Energizer Battery Trophy went to Glenn Ross. Ireland's strongest man was now Britain's strongest man. So that's it from Alton Towers. Hope you enjoyed this year's final. And the next challenge for Britain's strongest man is to see if in a few months' time he can become the world's strongest man. And for that, we'll see you in Malta.
He may not have quite the muscle, but Brad Pitt fans are in for a treat tonight, because BBC One has a movie double bill kicking off at 9:30 with the sci-fi thriller 12 Monkeys, co-starring Bruce Willis, followed by more Pitt action at 11:35 in Across the Tracks.